How are you feeling?
What's up, everybody? And also, David, thank you so much for resubbing. What was that, 9 months? Now that you've been with us? What a treasure it has been to have the support and affiliation with David Tavarish here at the Subversive History Enterprise.
It's been real, you know?
Yeah.
Quick, David, get a Rodney emote before they do. Damn it! Wait, no, I could probably do that while we're streaming, right?
Guys, it's a very special day today. Today is the first day of How Europe Underdeveloped Africa by Walter Rodney.
Right, that's the only special thing about today, right?
I agree. It's the only special thing about
today. It's the only special thing. If maybe you'll look above us, chat, you'll see, very special sub goal today, right? Will we be able to reach it? You know, only time can tell.
What does the special sub goal represent?
Do you see what the description of the sub goal is?
Oh, look at that. Look at that. Yeah, I guess it is my birthday today.
Happy birthday, homie.
Thank you. Thank you, Johnny. Thank you. Also, I don't know why it says 33. I am only 25 years old. It's kind of weird. It's kind of weird that it would be 33. That's kind of an arbitrary number for my birthday sub goal because I am only 25 years old today. Mm-hmm. No, I'm just kidding. I am 33 years of age today.
Did you smoke a lot of wet?
I did smoke a lot of wet. Yeah.
All right. I have this theory that, like, you know, the embalming fluid.
It's not literally embalming.
I know it's not literally embalming fluid, but something about it just like has kept me just forever young. You know.
Yeah. Shing. Yeah. But also, we also did stop doing, like, drinking alcohol and shit when we were, like, 23. I was 23. I don't know how old you were. You
22.
22. I quit smoking by the time I was, like, 25. So, like, you know, I think when a lot of, like, people are getting into their stride of, like, going to the bar and getting drunk all the time and smoking cigarettes and all kinds of, like, I kind of did all that from, like, 15 on. And then the past decade or so, I think I've aged a little bit more gracefully than others. What?
I said, thank you, Tay. She said, we're both cute.
Oh, thank you so much, Tay. Man, what's up, everybody? So good. And also, Idan Simpson, I don't know if you're still in here or not. Thank you so much for the raid. I didn't, we were doing the whole thing.
We were doing the pregame debate, you know, that way, you know, we get it out of our system and that, you know, by the time we have our faces on screen, it's like, okay, we're good. Now let's fight with chat. I stopped drinking at 25. I still do once a year or so, though. I haven't had a single alcoholic beverage in 11 and a half years. I've had non-alcoholic beverages since then, and I've had some kombucha in the meantime, but
I do be drinking booch.
It's good, you know. It's good for you. Good gut health. Lucky I'm still hot. Don't smoke or drink it. They mean show hog in the call before stream chat. I've been there. Yeah, this is true. And stop giving out secrets, David. Where we just, you know, both are just propelling our dicks around, you know.
Johnny, before we get into Walter Rodney book that we'll be reading today, can you bring up the poll? I want to give chat stream every stream we should do give an update on the poll.
So I see that you all just hate my choice, chat.
Take care of Tay. Thank you so much for gifting the sub to Daisy. Thank you for contributing to the Pat birthday sub goal. Appreciate that so much.
What's the ceremony for taking the book off the shelf? Oh, fuck.
We did it at the same time. It was part of the other ceremony.
Okay. Like, all right.
It when I did the put back, I brought the other one. Yeah. So, you know, as you can see here, this is our Patreon. This is the current poll for the next book that we will be reading. Yeah, maybe it is a little weak, Larry. Maybe you're right. Maybe we need to do something a little more formal for that. Your suggestion has been noted.
Maybe we need to get you like a pulley system, like right above your desk. That way like, you know, lowers down from the heavens. It's like new book.
Yeah. So, you know, we do have, these are the four books that we are, that are currently eligible for the next book that we will read after, How Europe Underdeveloped Africa. It includes The Brothers, which is a book about the Dulles brothers, which I assume most of the people in our chat already know about this situation a bit here. You know, Dulles brothers were former corporate lawyers who kind of stumbled their way into essentially running the CIA, responsible for numerous fucking, you know, American foreign policy atrocities across the Third World during their tenure with the State Department. This one has actually been elected by our close member of the community, Plants Fanon. So that's there. That one is currently in the lead. Currently in the lead with two votes. So, I mean, this is still anybody's race, but the Brothers is there.
Yes. In the lead. Steely Dan Halen. The Dulles Airport ruining the world fame, Dulles Brothers.
Thank you, Wilco. Appreciate that. Then we have CIA as organized crime, which was elected by our very, very treasured mod and community member, Strinsam. This is, I think that this is kind of a, you know, the title pretty much gives it away, how the CIA has acted in accordance with and as a function of organized crime throughout its history of nefarious dealings. Then we have a great book, which is no votes yet. And honestly, this was my dark horse to win the whole thing. Me and Johnny had a discussion, about who we thought would win. And I went with liberalism. I thought that this was the dark horse. I thought it was going to come from behind. It still could, because it's Domenico Lacerto, because it trashes liberalism. You know, liberalism is really about all of the, it's called a counter history liberalism, because it kind of takes everything that liberalism claims to stand for and pokes holes in it and examines how the authors or the writers, philosophers that kind of propped up liberalism and the governments that have claimed it did things that were anything but liberal. And that was Johnny's choosing there. Now, I chose Late Victorian Holocaust by Mike Davis, which I kind of refer to as the Black Book of Capitalism in a way, because it talks about famines that happened around the world because of the introduction of capitalism, because of the tampering with age-old ways of organizing land and feeding a community, and then you just go in and just force a cash crop capitalistic system on it, and then next, you know, 10 million people starve to death because you've tampered with things that have worked for generations. One of my favorite books I've ever read, but, you know, that's the thing. Here's the good news. Here's the good news. It's not about what my favorite is. Mm-hmm. You can go and you can make the choice here of what you would like us to discuss out of this.
We're putting it in your hands.
And you can purchase democracy here. So if you want to be part of that purchase democracy, join the Patreon. You can join for really whatever amount you want. We have two tiers, a $2 tier and a $5 tier, but I didn't even know you could do this. You can pledge however much you want. You can pledge $1 and you can still vote. We're not really, our Patreon's still so small that we're not really, you know, being too restrictive in terms of contribution. So if you want to contribute $1 just so that you can vote for the month, great. We would very much appreciate that. Now, I do want to give a shout out to everyone who is currently a part of our Patreon. Oh, did we just get a new one? We did get a new one. Wow, what a very special person who just joined. Wilco, thank you so much. I appreciate that. So let's give a shout out to everybody here that is a part of our Patreon. So Magyar Guy, thank you so much. Ninja Can, thank you so much. Has Ninja Can been around? I feel like we haven't seen Ninja Can in like two streams.
No, he was here, I think, for one of, near like the end of like the last one, I think it was.
Strinsam, thank you so much. Pollen, thank you so much. Ryalan, thank you so much. I know that I've been saying your name wrong. I may be still saying it wrong. Plants Fanon, thank you so much. Mystery Daniel, thank you so much. All good. Thank you so much. Mystery Page, thank you so much. Salty Commie, new Patreon subscriber. Thank you so much, Salty Commie. I know I see you all the time and appreciate the support. And then also the newest member of the Patreon community, Wilco. Thank you so very much, Wilco, for your contribution. I look forward to you casting your vote here.
Yeah, I don't think we've alienated Ninja Can just quite yet.
Well, if we have alienated them, they're still a part of our Patreon. Who really wins in the end?
Ninja Can has a new GF. Oh, damn. All right, congratulations, Ninja Can.
Yeah, congratulations.
Totally understandable for why you cannot Ninja Can't, or why you Ninja Can't right now. I get it. His left hand. Ayo. All right. So, yeah. hop on the Patreon, vote for the book that you want us to read after we start today's book, How Europe Underdeveloped Africa by Walter Rodney.
Yeah, and also this book is significantly shorter than the last book that we read. So the date that we're going to be reading this next book will be coming much quicker than this last project that we embarked on.
Yeah, it's going to happen pretty fast. We're it's going to be a brutal trek, especially for all of the other fellow pale faces in chat. We're all going to have to confront some inner demons.
Yeah,
right?
We're gonna have to atone for some, cultural,
for some inner some white devils, that lie inside of us all.
This is the crucible that all white Western leftists, should and, in my opinion, must walk through.
Right. Choose the length.
This self-flagellation, is necessary if you want to read and understand. Truly understand, but just to have like a to offer some kind of like, is it sympathy or empathy? Which is the one where you actually haven't been through it, but you that's sympathy, right?
Yeah. Sympathy. Empathy?
That's empathy. Okay. So we're expressing the one that we it's like a solidarity, but we haven't been through it.
Yeah. It's like when other people feel things, you're afflicted by it as well. Right.
If you're a white leftist, shut the fuck up and read. That is the underlying motto here of Subversive History. Like, that's kind of like really like the underlying vibe here of the Subversive History project.
I was making a joke about empaths, but I guess whatever, kind of flies under the radar. My jokes are for me. All right. I think it was funny. It's been noted and submitted to the council. Bah, bah, bah. Empathy is the steeled political sense of this love. That's really deep, Dubby. So, all right. Raiders, especially, Dan Simpson, Raiders, if you're still in here and you're wondering, like, why are these two white guys still talking about books and stuff, book this, book that, what the fuck is this about, right? Well, what we do here, right, we are Subversive History. We're a multimedia community project seeking to bring attention to the revolutionary struggles of the world's often unsung and frequently misunderstood sectors. These are the stories of the demonized, vilified, whitewashed, or otherwise forgotten campaigns against imperialism, colonialism, capitalist exploitation, and racial apartheid. The orthodoxy of Western hegemony has often labeled these dissidents as subversive. And these are the struggles that we aim to illuminate to you. And if you join our Discord, which I feel like we should probably update the link for that.
Yeah, I was just about to say that's probably something that we should be also, because there will be a great migration.
Yes.
There is a great migration coming if you are part of the Subversive History community, if you're part of our Discord especially, or if you have an anticipation of joining our Discord, just know that within 48 hours on Friday the 13th, Halloween Friday the 13th, which is pretty funny, we will be fusing what is the thing in Dragon Ball Z?
Oh, fusion, huh?
We will be doing this here.
Yeah, we'll be becoming the Gotenks of,
yes, exactly, where we'll be joining the left flank. We're merging, not necessarily joining, it's kind of gonna be like a merger, where we will be under the same umbrella as left flank vets.
Yes, fusion dance.
Fusion dance is what we do.
Fusion dance. Why is this not fucking doing it? There you go. That should be it. That should be the right one.
Subversive veterans.
Yeah, no. Me and Pat are both veterans of the class war, So I think that counts. Yeah, left flank history, Yeah, there it is. Yeah, it's somewhere in there. We haven't thought of like a good name yet. So yeah. You'll notice that the Discord server says left flank. All right.
Just, give it time.
It rolls right off the tongue. You'll get with it. It'll be fine. That's the rebrand right there, too. We have a hive mind. Don't mind us yet. the only white culture is going into the street and having a drunk riot when a genocide is declared once again with feeling.
Noted.
Noted. Oh, chat. Oh, did you send me the thing?
Oh, no, I didn't even send it to you yet. Wow, look at me.
No, we're good. Don't worry about it. No worries. Everything's fine. We're all fine here. I'm
drunk off my birthday stupor.
Trust me, I know exactly what it's like to stream on your birthday. I can't tell if you're just extremely... Oh, there we go.
What happened?
You were extremely still for longer than a couple seconds. And I was like, is he there?
I can become extremely still if necessary.
Yeah. It's all that Brazilian jiu-jitsu training to...
Thank you, Frozen Bananas. Appreciate you.
Chat, you're going to love these new slides.
I don't know how I feel about this.
No, this is... You just need to include, like, I think a little bit of red and black, right?
Well, I don't draw it. These are templates. It's not like I fucking...
I'm just saying, like, if you just were able to find a way to include, like, a little bit of red and black, we can get, like, you know, some nice...
What I try to do is I try to match the cover a little bit. Like, I try to have it kind of, like, match the theme of the cover as best as possible.
I think you did a pretty good job doing that.
Thank you. Thank you. Pinned by Magyar guy. Thank you so much. We looking kind of fresh though. Oh, also, kind of cool. But you know, friend of the community, Philbo Schwaggins is. We're in discussion for them to create a little bit of an intro song for our produced content, maybe for the stream too. I don't know, but you know, little song to kind of slide in to lubricate your entry into the Subversive History universe.
Yeah. The Irish and Jewish people would be the same if the US didn't need settler colonial shock troops imported. All right.
I think that's a reference to like the Gerald Horn style of, yeah. Guess what? You're white now because we need more white people.
Exactly. Yeah.
We feel you, dummy.
Yeah. Yeah. I would also love to, at some point, read another Gerald Horn book.
Yeah, and Chris the Nerd TV, also, you know, my name is Patrick. You know, I have other very Irish names that I'm not going to, you know, fully list all of my middle and last name.
Very good. Very good.
I am quite, you know, and like, I try not, you know, obviously I don't do the cringe white thing of being like, well, actually, I'm Irish. And that actually means that I've suffered under colonialism also. But I do feel a modicum of comfort knowing that, like, you know, well, you know, the Irish came over here and were, you know, immediately cops and whatnot. You know what I mean? There's a lot of blemishes on the Irish American history, but I guess in like a European context, in a Western European context, it's certainly better than being British. It's certainly better than being German.
Yeah.
It's certainly better than being French.
Yeah.
Most of those countries in Western Europe, I'd rather be Irish than. So that's really what I'm trying to say here. that's what I'm putting forward.
And dummy, we are tempted to read Sakai, but
I got settlers right here. Maybe that'll be a good election for the next poll. You know what I mean? Maybe the next poll if you
play your cards right.
Yeah.
Well, Irish Parliament still has people defending.
Ireland has been actually way, compared to Europe and the Western world, Ireland has always been a staunch, and I, you know, I think it does have to do a little bit with the colonialism that the Irish suffered under for many generations. And still to this day, you know what I mean, there is a divided island there. And there's
the six northern counties.
And there's still portions that are of the governmental structure that are still like subordinate to the queen somehow. I think that drums up quite a bit of anti-colonial sentiment. So
I think it's a king Ireland now because Lizzie's in a box.
Ninja Can, there you are. Did the Great Class War end?
Yeah, it's over.
We made it.
Weren't you here for it?
We made it.
I'm like almost certain I remember you being here for the last episode.
I think criticizing the Maoist third worldism in the latter half is also an interesting component of reading the work. Yeah, for sure.
Yeah,
I agree. I think there's a lot of good stuff to be learned from reading Settlers and Sakai. You know, I'm not a Maoist and I'm not a third worldist, so I don't parade Settlers around like it's a Bible. Like, I think that book has gotten way too controversial, and the controversy blunts the value of the book, because it's become divisive and derisive. Like, it's like either like every page has to be like a dogma for you to move forward from that forward, or you don't read it because it's cringe and there's cringe people that talk about reading it. And it's like, both of those are incorrect.
Do you remember the meme where like random leftists on the internet were just like posting links to like read Settlers?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, it was like a meme thing at that point to like read Settlers, and like, you should read Settlers, but also chill out a little bit.
Have you ever considered trying to get Irish residence? Did your family immigrate further back than your great-grandparents?
My great-grandparents were already in the United States, so I'm not sure how far back it would need to go.
Yes, I would love to cover some work by Glenn Sean Coulthard. That would be great. I think he's like working on a new book right now, too. But did Snake defeat Angel? Oh, my fucking God, Ninja Can. Jesus.
That was the worst, man. That was the worst betrayal.
That was number one anime betrayal. Like,
the Angel Lamp. God damn it, dude. That was so stupid. Who looked at that and was like, put it out?
Publish.
Well, also, and we talked about this last time, but it's like it wasn't even like he was just by the water cooler joking around with two things he found. It's like they wrapped filming for that day, and he's like, "Hey guys, do you mind if we do the Angel Snake thing that I was talking about? Like, I'm gonna set up over here. I'm gonna bring it, get the camera out there, and everything. I'm gonna speak directly into the camera. I have a thing that I want to do."
Right.
Like, that's what happened there, and it's like, what the fuck is going through your mind there? Like, first of all, not only was it like racist, but it was just like, none of the jokes were actually that good or anything like that. Like,
well, this is what happens when most of your team is like Western Europeans that, you know, are like, "Ha, no, that's very funny."
Precisely.
He's doing a Japanese accent.
Yeah. So.
So, all right. Today, we are starting How Europe Underdeveloped Africa, and we're going to be reading the foreword, the preface, and the introduction.
Important to note, the foreword is written by one Angela Davis. And a cool thing about today's stream is we're not only going to be talking about Walter Rodney, but we're also going to be talking about a couple other very prominent figures in Black radical history. We're going to be talking about Angela Davis. We're going to be talking about Frantz Fanon. We're going to be talking about C.L.R. James. Some of you are going to get very upset at the C.L.R. James video. So I need everybody to put on their big person pants and prepare that there may be, like, you know, a Black person from the colonial Caribbean that is not, you know, directly in line with certain political figures. So I need everybody to just start gearing up their preparation for that and just, you know, buckle up and you know, bear through it.
Everybody just be cool. All right. Oh, fuck. I keep forgetting I'm a mod. I got to watch my mouth a bit. What did you even say? I don't even... What is it? Hail? Did you see Kyle or something, Ninja Can? What did you do?
Ninja Can.
I'm native. I'm used to dealing with that bullshit from Marxists. Yeah, no, I know, liar.
Yeah, right.
So,
right.
Like...
Bilbo, you know, what's up? I saw your message. I want to get back. So I'm sorry. I'm like, I worked all day today. I'm doing all kinds of random stuff. And...
Okay.
We will get with you. We will message you. I apologize for being... I only have like a... So sporadic with the messages and everything like that, but we will get this nailed down. I apologize.
Oh, then you can. That's going to come up in your, you know, annual review.
Yeah, Wilco has noted it. Tay has noted it. and, you know, they'll be knocking.
I thought he just said the word hail, and I was like, whatever. It's like a Black metal thing, right?
Yeah.
We'll make sure you go to heaven for working so hard.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, Zach.
Yeah, Leaping Larry, yeah, that's kind of like the thing. Like, oh, you know, Glenn doesn't like this thing China does, so throw out all
time to throw out all that, you know, like
this is worthless. Yeah, this is a problem when you get a little bit too deeply sectarian, you know, with, you know, the theory and historical perspective that you read.
Yeah, like it's one thing when you're listening to speeches by the author. It's another thing when you are actually engaging with the author's work, reading what they have written, right? It's kind of like saying that, like, you're like, I don't know, a huge John Coltrane fan, right? Like, you have all the records, but you've only ever actually, like, looked at, like, the record. You've never actually listened to John Coltrane. You know what I mean?
Yes.
Like, I don't know. I don't know how to put it. So, do you want to do the first one or should I?
I'll do the first one.
Okay.
All right. So, when Walter Rodney was assassinated in 1980, at the young age of 38, he had already accomplished what few scholars achieved during careers that extend considerably longer than his. The field of African history would never be the same after the publication of How Europe Underdeveloped Africa. At the same time, this meticulously researched analysis of the abiding repercussions of European colonialism on the continent of Africa has radicalized approaches to anti-racist activism throughout the world. In fact, the term scholar-activist acquires its most vigorous meaning when it is employed to capture the generative passion that links Walter Rodney's research to his determination to rid the planet of all the outgrowths of colonialism and slavery. Almost 40 years after his death, we certainly need such brilliant examples of what it means to be a resolute intellectual who recognizes that the ultimate significance of knowledge is its capacity to transform our social words. Well, I read this before, and like, I'm actually very, very, like, just reading it out loud, Angela Davis's writing is very, very good.
Yeah.
I you know, I know that there's like very, you know, very important books that she's done on sexism and things like that. And so, like, you know, sexism with race and things like that, very important books that she's written. I've only read her book where she does a narrative introduction to the life of Frederick Douglass. That's actually the only writing that I've read of Angela Davis. And it was fantastic, but just reading that was very good. If only her politics held up, did they not?
In her old age, you know, she's maybe softened the hard edge that she had in her youth, you know.
Mm-hmm.
It's one of those things, but I don't know. I'm not gonna say one way or the other because who am I to, like, you know, criticize Angela fucking Davis? You know what I mean? I don't feel comfortable doing that, you know, especially on this platform.
Other people definitely can, though. You know,
Yeah.
I'm not saying you shouldn't just.
Yeah. Especially because I haven't really engaged with her work, right? You know, or like, you know, listened to every single fucking interview by Angela Davis, nor have I ever even had like a conversation with her or something. I'm not going to be like that. You know what I mean? Wow. Pat can read impressive. LOL. It's a powerful opening statement, though. Glenn Sean Coulthard is the book we did before, Lacerdo book, Red Skin, White Mask. Ah, okay. Yes. That, I hope that explains that to you, Sin Chow. Yeah. He's a really good author. Definitely read it. But do they write as good as the Bible? Be out thou shall foul cow, famous book. Yeah. We have learned from Walter Rodney and those before and after him who have critically engaged with Marxism while developing historical analyses of colonialism and slavery, that challenging capitalism's deeply entrenched suppositions about human nature and progress is one of the most important tasks of theorists and activists who set out to dismantle structures and ideologies of racism. In refuting the argument that Africa's subordination to Europe emanated from a natural propensity toward stagnation, Rodney also repudiates the ideological assumption that external intervention alone would be capable of provoking progress on the continent. Although colonization officially lasted only 70 years or so, which, as Rodney points out, was a relatively short period, it was during this period that colossal changes took place in the capitalist world, i.e. in Europe and the United States, as well as in the emergent socialist world, especially in Russia and China. To mark time, he insists, or even to move slowly while others leap ahead, is virtually equivalent to going backward. In How Europe Underdeveloped Africa, Walter Rodney painstakingly argues that imperialism and the various processes that bolstered colonialism created impenetrable structural blockades to economic and thus also political and social progress on the continent. At the same time, his argument is not meant to absolve Africans of the ultimate responsibility for development. I think we got anonymous gifter. Thank you for gifting.
Leaping Larry, thank you so much. Very deserving anonymous gift there to Leaping Larry. Leaping Larry, please enjoy. Thank you. And also thank you so much for contributing to the Happy Birthday Pat Slorb goal. We are slowly creeping to one gifted sub or one sub per year of age of my life. If you would like to contribute to that, please, we will make sure the money goes to a good cause.
It's an excellent birthday present for Pat.
We love you.
We love you. Thank you.
We care for you.
It's like Idiocracy.
Okay. Yeah. Here's a quick little, I feel like if we're reading Angela Davis's words, we've never done any kind of like, you know, this is just a quick little bio on Angela Davis. I think it's cool to look through. And I'm going to pee real quick.
Welcome to Black in Review, where we empower the world to learn more about Black history. Today, we're taking a closer look at the life and legacy of Angela Davis, a political activist, academic, and author who has been a leading figure in the civil rights movement. Remember to like, subscribe, and share. This is another Black in Review moment.
Was that the entire video?
Born in Birmingham, Alabama in 1944, Angela Davis faced discrimination and racism from an early age. But her parents instilled in her a sense of social justice and the importance of education. Despite the obstacles she faced, she went on to become one of the most important figures in the civil rights movement. Join us as we take a closer look at her childhood, her activism, her accomplishments, and her later years. Angela Davis had a humble and determined childhood. She was the daughter of a teacher and an industrial worker. She grew up in a time of deep racial segregation in the American South and faced discrimination and racism on a daily basis. Her parents were active in the civil rights movement and instilled in her a sense of social justice and the importance of education from an early age. Despite the challenges she faced, she excelled in school and graduated as valedictorian of her high school class. Her academic success earned her a full scholarship to Brandeis University, where she studied French and philosophy and was one of only three Black students on campus at the time. Her time at Brandeis marked her first exposure to the civil rights movement, and she became involved in the movement early on, joining the Black Panthers and working as a leader in the Communist Party USA. After her undergraduate degree, she went on to attend the University of Frankfurt, where she earned her PhD in philosophy. This education would become the foundation for her future activism and scholarship. Her early life experiences and education laid the foundation for her future activism and her unwavering commitment to social justice. Angela Davis's activism and scholarship has focused on issues of race, gender, and class, and she has been an advocate for the oppressed throughout her life. One of Davis's biggest accomplishments was her role in the civil rights movement of the 1960s. Her activism helped to bring attention to issues of racial inequality and police brutality, and she was a vocal advocate for the rights of prisoners. She became involved in the movement early on, joining the Black Panthers and working as a leader in the Communist Party USA. Her speeches and writings helped to raise awareness about the injustices faced by Black Americans and advocated for their rights. Her activism and scholarship helped to shape the civil rights movement in the 1960s and continues to inspire others today. Throughout her career, Angela Davis has continued to be a voice for the marginalized and oppressed, using her platform to speak out against injustices and advocate for change. She has been an inspiration for generations of activists, and her contributions to the civil rights movement have had a lasting impact on American society. One of the most defining moments of Angela Davis's career was her trial and acquittal in 1970. She was arrested and charged with conspiracy in connection with a prison escape attempt, which resulted in the deaths of several individuals. The trial became a major media event and a cause célèbre of the civil rights movement. Davis faced intense scrutiny and was the subject of a nationwide manhunt prior to her arrest. Her legal team faced numerous obstacles, including the dismissal of several African American jurors and the judge's decision to allow evidence of her membership in the Communist Party to be introduced. Despite the odds against her, Davis was able to prove her innocence, and she was acquitted on all charges. The trial and acquittal of Angela Davis brought her international attention and made her a symbol of resistance to racism and political repression. Her acquittal was a major victory for the civil rights movement and demonstrated the power of a determined individual to overcome injustice. It also marked a turning point in Davis's career, and she became a leading figure in the civil rights movement and an advocate for social justice and equality. Angela Davis is not only known for her activism, but also for her work as an academic and author. Throughout her career, she has been a professor of ethnic studies at San Francisco State University, the University of California, Santa Cruz, and the University of California, Berkeley. In addition to her teaching, Davis has also been a prolific author, writing several books on subjects such as race, gender, and social justice. Her first book, Women, Race, and Class, was published in 1981 and has since become a classic in the field of feminist studies. She has also written Blues Legacies and Black Feminism, which explores the connection between the blues, black feminism, and the civil rights movement, and Are Prisons Obsolete, which argues for the abolition of the prison industrial complex. Davis has also been a major figure in the feminist movement, and her work has been influential in shaping the discourse on intersectionality and the experiences of black women. Through her writing and teaching, Davis has been able to share her insights on social justice and inspire generations of activists and scholars. She has continued to speak out on issues of racial and social justice, and has been a vocal advocate for the rights of marginalized communities. She has also been a prominent voice in the movement to abolish the prison industrial complex, and her work has helped to bring attention to the issue of mass incarceration in the United States.
Thank you, Powerful Finger.
Davis has also been recognized for her contributions to the civil rights movement and social justice. She has received numerous awards and honors, including the Lifetime Achievement Award from the National Civil Rights Museum and the United States Presidential Medal of Freedom. Angela Davis is a trailblazer and a true icon of the civil rights movement. Through her tireless activism, she has fought against racism and oppression, and her work has helped to bring about real change in the world. She has been a powerful voice for the marginalized and oppressed, and has served as an inspiration to countless others. Her childhood, her activism, her scholarship, and her later years all have played a major role in shaping the world we live in today. She has been a leader, an educator, and a voice for change. Angela Davis will always be remembered as a true leader and hero in the fight for civil rights and social justice. Her legacy will continue to inspire future generations to fight for a more just and equal world. This has been another Black in Review moment. Thanks for watching. Please subscribe to our channel for more videos on activists like Angela Davis.
So we did not comment, but we did subscribe and like the video. I hope you're happy, Wilco.
Very good. Very good.
I did it for you.
All right. So just a little intro to Angela Davis there. You know, this stream is not necessarily about Angela Davis, but we are reading her intro to this book, or her foreword to this book, which is a pretty cool thing to have the foreword by Angela Davis, I think.
No, you said that we should like and subscribe, Wilco, and comment. I didn't comment, though. All right, well, you know, for anybody that has never heard of Angela Davis, dummy, all right.
Find a 7-minute biography of Angela Davis. You know what I mean? Like, there is enough content in that video to know, like, the main points of Angela Davis's life.
I know chat loves our, like, you know, 25-minute videos where it's just me and Pat, like, watching the video with you.
Yeah. The whole thing is black in review. Are you saying that the whole black in review channel is a fake channel?
Intro AI voice. Angela Davis is a black woman. Oh, okay.
Noted.
So, oh shit, this is me reading, isn't it?
This is you.
So, I'm not reading that comment. To quote, I feel extremely privileged to have been able to meet Walter Rodney during my first trip to the African continent in 1973. I mentioned this visit to Dar es Salaam because it took place shortly after the original publication of How Europe Underdeveloped Africa, and because I witnessed firsthand for a brief period of time the revolutionary urgency generated within the scholarly and activist circles surrounding him. Not only did I have the opportunity to witness lectures and discussions he organized at the University of Dar es Salaam, but on the relation between African liberation and global contestations to capitalism. But I also visited the training camps of the MPLA, where I met Agostinho Neto and the military cadre fighting the Portuguese army. Walter Rodney's analysis reflected both a sober, well-reasoned historical investigation shaped by Marxist categories and critiques, and a deep sense of the historical conjuncture defined by global revolutionary upheavals, especially by African liberation struggles at that time.
Very good. Very good.
So, I mean, there's so many things in that short, you know, little paragraph that, like, you know, I'm sure we're going to take a deep dive into as we get further into the book regarding, like, the MPLA and the cadre and fighting Portuguese army.
I mean, that's not really what this book is about, though. This book isn't about Walter Rodney's life. It's about how Europe underdeveloped Africa. So we probably won't be talking about that. Really, this type of stuff is going to be stuff we're briefly going into right now. The preface, the foreword, and the intro is really kind of like a biographical introduction to Walter Rodney as a person. That's what we're going over today. And then next on Sunday, we'll be doing the first actual chapter of How Europe Developed Africa, Underdeveloped Africa, by reading Rodney's words. We're not even really into Rodney's words just yet.
Right.
All right. So, because he was such a methodical scholar, he did not ignore gender issues. Even though he wrote without the benefit of the feminist vocabularies and frameworks of analysis that were later developed, others have pointed out that he would have no doubt given greater emphasis to these questions had he been active at a later time. Nonetheless, at several strategic junctures in the text, Rodney addresses the role of gender, and he is careful to point out that under colonialism, Africa women's social, religious, constitutional, and political privileges and rights disappeared, while the economic exploitation continued and was often intensified. He emphasizes that the impact of colonialism on labor in Africa redefined men's work as modern, while constituting women's work as traditional or backward. Therefore, the deterioration in the status of women's work was bound up with the consequent loss of their right to set indigenous standards of what work had merit and what did not. At the time that How Europe Developed Africa was published, black activism, at least in the United States, was influenced not only by cultural nationalist notions of intrinsic female inferiority, often fallaciously attributed to African cultural practices, but also by officially sponsored attributions of a matriarchal, in other words, defective family structure to U.S. black communities, e.g. the 1965 Moynihan Report. This book was an important tool for those of us who were intent on contesting such essentialist notions of gender within black radical movements of that era. So this isn't something that I particularly knew about Rodney, that he was kind of ahead of his time in terms of progressivism on feminist issues.
Well, I mean, he only lived to like the age of 30. So, you know, I assume that because of like, you know, him being like a young man, like he was kind of like consistently looking towards the future. I don't know. That's just like a guess. I don't fucking know. I didn't know the guy.
I don't know that guy.
I didn't know him personally like that, you know? Just making, you know, nebulous assumptions. So if Walter Rodney's scholarly and activist contributions exemplified what was most demanded at that particular historical moment, He was assassinated because he believed in the real possibility of radical political change, including in Guyana, his natal land. His ideas are even more valuable today at a time when capitalism has so forcibly asserted its permanency. And when once existing organized opposing forces, not only the socialist community of nations, but also the non-aligned nations, have been virtually eliminated, those of us who refuse to concede that global capitalism represents the planet's best future and that Africa and the former Third World are destined to remain forever ensconced in the poverty of underdevelopment are confronted with this crucial question: how can we encourage radical critiques of capitalism as integral to struggles against racism as we also advance the recognition that we cannot envision the dismantling of capitalism as long as the structures of racism remain intact? In this sense, it is up to us to follow, expand upon, and deepen Walter Rodney's legacy.
Right. And this is like conversations that we've had with Rick, that we've had with Falcon. I'm sure we've had this conversation with Larry, other indigenous comrades here. And it's that, and we also covered this when we read Marx at the Margins, when we read Karl Marx's view of racism as it relates to emancipatory revolutionary movements, that, you know, Karl Marx said, you cannot have white liberation while black flesh is in chains, or something along those lines. I'm paraphrasing it, but that's essentially what he says. And it's something that, like, you know, and this is something that we've pointed out with Israel, you know what I mean? That in the kibbutz movements that were like maybe economically co-opt socialism in some way, that we would never say that those are socialist because they operated in one extremely mutually exclusive quality of what we consider to be socialism.
Right. We're a close, tight-knit community that nobody has any personal, like, belongings and stuff, and we all kind of, like, you know, share everything and share responsibilities and stuff, and, like, you know, we're self-sufficient and all this other shit, and there's, like, no sexism and ba-ba-ba-ba-ba, right? But the issue is that, like, you're doing all of that, like, on stolen land, right? And it the whole, like, the existence, right, of these kibbutzes is predicated on stolen land and dispossessing the land from another people.
Right. And those things, as we said, are mutually exclusive.
Yeah.
Red Falcon, you have ads right now, dude.
How?
You gifted like 12 subs last week to various people within the chat, and you didn't even have yourself subbed. Rebel Communique, hey, how are you?
Hey, welcome.
How does that happen, Red Falcon? Just so selfless, Red Falcon.
Selfless.
Selfless in their giving.
Yeah, also, Raiders, if you haven't refreshed, you know.
Hey, Crackle Bear, thank you so much for gifting a Red Falcon a gifted sub there. So deserving of a gifted sub. You know, I don't know, whenever he has, you know, the means to spare, he gives out a ton of gifted subs in the channel when he has the opportunity. So thank you so much for giving to him, because he deserves it so much. Also, thank you so much for contributing to the Happy Birthday Pat Slorb goal, one sub per year of life that I've existed on this planet. Thank you so much. We are slowly creeping there. Who knows if we'll actually get there, but, you know, it's a nice gesture.
Give what you can. Show Pat your love, monetarily.
The Slorb goal.
The Slorb goal.
Now, here's a little video, Angela Davis on violence and revolution, and, you know, take from it what you will.
Yeah, but the question is more, how do you get there? Do you get there by confrontation, violence?
Oh, is that the question you were asking?
Yeah.
See, that's another thing. When you talk about revolution,
thank you so much for paying forward the gifted sub that you got from Crackle Bear, and thank you so much for contributing to the Pat birthday Slorb goal. Thank you so much.
That's another thing. When you talk about a revolution, most people think violence, without realizing that the real content of any kind of revolutionary thrust lies in the principles and the goals that you're striving for, not in the way you reach them. On the other hand, because of the way this society is organized, because of the violence that exists on the surface everywhere, you have to expect that there are going to be such explosions. You have to expect things like that as reactions. If you are a black person and live in the black community all your life and walk out on the street every day seeing white policemen surrounding you, when I was living in Los Angeles, for instance, long before the situation in LA ever occurred, I was constantly stopped. No, the police didn't know who I was, but I was a black woman, and I had a natural, and they, I suppose, thought that I might be a, quote, militant. And when you live under a situation like that constantly, and then you ask me, you know, whether I approve of violence. I mean, that just doesn't make any sense at all. Whether I approve of guns. I grew up in Birmingham, Alabama. Some very, very good friends of mine were killed by bombs that were planted by racists. I remember from the time I was very small, I remember the sounds of bombs exploding across the street, our house shaking. I remember my father having to have guns at his disposal at all times because of the fact that at any moment someone we might expect to be attacked.
Thank you, Salty
Connie.
The man
who was at that time in complete control of the city government, his name was Bull Connor, would often get on the radio and make statements like, niggas have moved into a white neighborhood, we better expect some bloodshed tonight. And sure enough, there would be bloodshed. After the four young girls who lived, one of them lived next door to me.
Hype Train is close.
I was very good friends with the sister of another one.
Yes,
my
Red
sister
Falcon.
Was
Day
very good
birthday.
Friends with all three of them. My mother taught one of them in her class. My mother, in fact, when the bombing occurred, one of the mothers of one of the young girls called my mother and said, can you take me down to the church to pick up Carol? We heard about the bombing.
Ninja Can, thank you so much for the bits.
And they went down, and what did they find? They found limbs
that
and
put us
heads
over the edge.
Strewn all
finished,
over
though.
The place. And then after that, in my neighborhood, all of the men organized themselves into an armed patrol. They had to take their guns and patrol our community every night.
Holy
because
shit.
They did not want that to happen again. I mean, that's why when someone asked me about violence, I just find it incredible. What it means is that the person who's asking that question has absolutely no idea what black people have gone through, what black people have experienced in this country since the time the first black person was kidnapped from the shores of Africa.
Did not want to interrupt the great speech there, and very prescient speech from Dr. Angela Davis, but holy shit, Crackle Barrel, 10 gifted subs. Absolutely fucking incredible. You're now in a level 3 hype train already. And this is only appropriate that we put on some Palestinian music. Thank you so much, Crackle Barrel. Thank you so much, Sin Chow, for that. Thank you so much, Salty Kami, for forwarding a gifted sub to Mama M Media, very deserving recipient. And also, thank you so much, Ninja Can, for the bits. Thank you, K, for the bits. So appreciated. And now, look at this. 17 out of the 33. We're over halfway into the gifted sub Happy Birthday Pat's floor goal.
Gonna do my best to show you.
Damn, I'm 33. That's why we set the sub goal at 33.
Gonna do my best to put on some good.
Whoa, Robo Gaming, thank you so much for gifting a gifted sub to Robo Gaming. Very, very deserving sub recipient. Also, I think we just made it to a level 4 hype train. Holy shit, guys. فلش البلد جدد البلد
حتلن البلد كسر طابوهات لتحسمس على البلد كشف على البلد شلل البلد Good God, Magyar.
Whoa, five gifted subs. Thank you so much. Puts us up to 23, man.
This is probably one of my favorite hip-hop groups ever. They're called Dom, D-A-M, all caps. They're amazing. They're like a super group of like Palestinian artists.
What about, you know, the MC Abdul, the the kid that raps from Gaza?
Yes, yes, the guy that's in this group, Tamer Nafar, he did that music video with him.
There you go, guy. Thank you so much again. You're so great. Oh, Tay, thank you so much for getting a tier one sub to Dummy Dorco. Wow, thank you so much. And Tay, appreciate it so much. Also, what was I? Oh, yeah, Red Falcon. We call it Luck of the Irish. Top of the morning to you. Man, and now the goal is only 9 subs away, which is insane. I did not foresee us making this much progress on this. Thank you so much. Making my birthday truly special. And I would rather be nowhere else than right here parked in front of this commuter talking about Walter Rodney to my beloved chat that comes and hangs out with me a couple days a week. Thank you so much. There's still time, Dummy Dorco.
Hey, Sam.
Thank you so much. For Rebel Communique, very deserving recipient. Thank you. 91% to a level 5. That's amazing.
Yeah, I hope you guys really like the next artist that I show you. In honor of what's been going on with Palestine, I'm gonna try and show you as many Palestinian artists as I can. And this guy is Saint Levant. You should definitely check him out on Instagram. You should definitely check him out on social media. His shit goes really hard. He's really good.
Thank you so much for the gifted sub. That puts us at a level 5 hype train. That's absolutely incredible. Amen Media, I have a pro-Palestine song if you want. I mean, we can keep doing this. I'll keep the pro-Palestine train
and also the fact that my girl doesn't like that I'm followed by me, a Khalifa. I'm in a position where people that's older than me look at me as a leader.
I bought several books recently, so just so you know, every time you contribute any dollar to us, this is pretty much what it goes. Most of the money goes to that enters my pockets. I just bought Norman Finkelstein's Gaza, an Inquest into its martyrdom. Just because I feel like I need a better contemporary idea of what's going on in Gaza. You know, Johnny and I read the ethnic cleansing of Palestine. We spent months reading it painstakingly, going through it with a fine-tooth comb. But that largely centered almost exclusively on the events of 1948. Also, with everything going on in the world right now, you are doing yourself a disservice if you are not listening to our podcast. The two-part podcast that we did on the events of 1948 and the preceding time period. To understand what's happening right now, it is always important to understand what was the progenitor of this entire conflict. And you can learn that in a very, very concise way, in my opinion, if you check out the Subversive History podcast that we did on this. Where's the link? Oh,
how insecure, how sad of you, how immature.
Yeah, he sings in English, French, and Arabic.
Red Falcon, the mythical, the mythical, devilishly handsome quintet. Would that be a quintet?
When you see a woman go double tap on my pose. When I was a kid, I remember I wore what I wanted. They used to make fun of my clothes. But looking back now, I just smile when I see them. Cause I know the girlfriends are all on my shows. Wassalam alaikum. Salt and malim fain. Maru malim alaikum. Cause they used to hate on my name.
Oh, also, Pat, did I tell you? I started Arabic on Duolingo.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Very good, very good. That'll help us when we take the Subversive History pilgrimage to the Middle East for Ramadan.
Yeah, no, all of his songs are really fucking good, chat. So check him out if you've never heard of him. It doesn't seem that difficult. I mean, like, reading it, I think, is probably going to be the most difficult part for me. Thank you, Mama M Media, for the submission.
Is this the Mama M submission?
Yeah, this is 47 cool. Soul, their Palestinian group that I actually have listened to before.
Out here it's madness, got to hold your ground. Won't let you down.
Yeah, no, Arabic hip hop just endlessly slaps. It's ridiculous.
فتح ما سكر معه بذبلان كشف لعن بتاريخك على ابو الزعلان بكره بيغرقوا بالطوف وكل ولادك حتشوف طردوا نجوم بسماك.
I mean, it's a very musical language commissar, so I'm definitely not surprised. I wore my black and white keffiyeh to a work thing today. Definitely will. Do you know Tay if he teaches specifically like Levantine Arabic, or is it like North African Arabic? We must stop it. One topic low key and 47 unlock it. One topic low key and 47 exploiting our difference. They poison the infants. A voice from the distance. Our choice is resistance. Parasites want to snatch your life, so I slap them twice when I grab the mic. Nationalize our abdicating and passing when we fraternize.
You get low key is literally rapping at this moment. Stops. Tell a friend to tell a friend to tell a friend to tell the cops. Sent to offend the mob.
Lengthen the renaissance. Heroes getting shot. Left to rock. There's a lot of stuff with what? Mint Press, right? It's got to hold your ground. My father won't let you down. Even if you left, had to sort things out. Won't let you down.
Let's play the song The Beak Ascent, and then let's. We do have to get back to the reading. We have a lot to do. You can revisit a little bit more of this stuff on Friday when you have lots of the structure.
Last one, chat, and then we're back to the reading, all right?
Yeah, my man. Yeah, collect your bangers. Team, assemble your bangers for Friday.
Ninja Kid, I'm not doing that. I'm not comparing communist revolutions that have happened.
tubes and you won't even glimpse of the news. They make money off the products that we're quick to consume, and it's not simply a question of differing views. Forget emotions.
Like, yeah, look at these two white guys, you know, like comparing communist revolutions. Like,
China actually, you know,
it's kind of mid. It's kind of,
yeah, I'd kind of give them a 3, I guess.
Definitely gonna rank Lao, you know, as the dark horse that beats
S-tier, the dark horse S tier communism. More rapidly, and we are automatically supporting pure savagery. Imagine how you feel if this was your family.
Rank counter revolutionary revolutions.
I
don't even know that many.
The Nazis.
We'd be here, like, that would be like a 12-hour stream.
Yeah. 1776, correct?
That is correct. Canada. You know, I feel like they probably had one at some point, right? No, did they? Did they ever even try?
Pretty much all of South America.
Thank you, V. Thank you, chat, for all of your submissions.
Yeah. Thank you so much, man. In, even if we don't get to 33, just what we've gotten so far is so heartwarming, and I'm so happy to have you here and the contributions that you all give. So thank you so very much.
I think, is this one me or you?
I think this is me.
Okay.
So now that was the foreword that was done by Angela Davis. Now we're moving into a quick preface. So this book derives from a concern with the contemporary African situation. It delves into the past only because otherwise it would be impossible to understand how the present came into being and what the trends are for the near future. In the search for an understanding of what is now called underdevelopment in Africa, the limits of inquiry have had to be fixed as far apart as the 15th century on the one hand, and at the end of the colonial period on the other hand. Ideally, an analysis of underdevelopment should come even closer to the present than the end of the colonial period in the 1960s. The phenomenon of neocolonialism cries out for extensive investigation in order to formulate the strategy and tactics of African emancipation and development. This study does not go that far, but at least certain solutions are implicit in a correct historical evaluation, just as given medical remedies are contraindicated by a correct diagnosis of a patient's conditions and an accurate case history. Hopefully, the facts and interpretation that follow will make a small contribution towards reinforcing the conclusion that African development is possible only on the basis of a radical break with the international capitalist system, which has been the principal agency of underdevelopment of Africa over the last 5 centuries.
She's breaking out them PhD words.
So, the principal agency of underdevelopment of Africa has been the international capitalist system over the past 5 decades.
Right. Which, if you were here, chat, this should all be like, yeah, wait, I learned about that when we went over the divide.
True.
Because the author, you know, very near and dear to their heart, talked a lot about Africa.
So, did I say 5 decades? I meant 5 centuries. That's what it said.
Yeah.
Sorry.
You're good. As the reader will observe, the question of development strategy is tackled briefly in the final section by A.M. Babu, former Minister of Economic Affairs and Development Planning, who has been actively involved in fashioning policy along those lines in the Tanzanian context. It is no accident that the text as a whole has been written within Tanzania, where expressions of concern for development have been accompanied by considerably more positive action than in several parts of the continent. Did y'all hear that helicopter flying over my house just now?
No,
okay, no, they didn't pick that up. All right, good. Many colleagues and camera many colleagues and comrades shared in the preparation of this work. Special thanks must go to comrades Karim Hirji and Henry Mapulu of the University of Dar es Salaam, who read the manuscript in a spirit of constructive criticism. But contrary to the fashion in most prefaces, I will not add that all mistakes and shortcomings are entirely my responsibility. That is sheer bourgeois subjectivism. Responsibility in matters of these sorts is always collective, especially with regard to the remedying of shortcomings. The purpose has been to try and reach Africans who wish to explore further the nature of their exploitation rather than satisfy the standards set by our oppressors and their spokesmen in the academic world.
There you go.
This okay. is also why we put the text on the page. That way, like, you know, little stuff like, you know, if we misread something or we accidentally mess something up, it's there for you guys too. To
well, I read it correctly, but I restated it incorrectly.
Yeah.
Okay. So, okay. And now this is the introduction. We just went through the preface. Now this is the introduction, which is also not written by Walter Rodney himself. So just keep that in mind. At the outset, before anything else is written, we need openly to acknowledge how difficult it has been for us to come to terms with the undeniable fact that Walter Rodney, our brother, friend, and comrade, is dead. On June 13, 1980, the author of this unparalleled work of historical analysis became the best-known victim of a systemic campaign of assassination and other forms of ruthless repression carried out by the governing authorities of his native land, Guyana. The end was predictable, for Walter had determined that the only path to true human development and liberation for the majority of the people in his country was through the transformation of their own lives in a struggle to replace and reshape the neo-colonialist government that had dominated their society and prescribed their existence. However, Forbes Burnham, the president of Guyana, had made it clear on many occasions that in this struggle for the minds and hearts of the people, he knew no limits in the determination to exterminate the forces of opposition. In the opinion of many, there is no doubt that the bomb that tore away the life of Walter Rodney was the result of Burnham's deadly pledge. So this is kind of long. I wasn't sure if we would watch the whole thing or not, but there was like, I just wanted to get into a little bit of his speaking and things like that. So we'll see how time shakes out here, but let's play some of this.
Okay, because I'm just letting you know, this is half an hour.
I know what it is.
All right. And there's no subtitles, chat, so.
Hello? Okay, was the food sitting out for a while or anything? Was the food, like, sitting out for a while? Thank you.
So real quick, chat. I don't know if you remember Chetty Jagan or Jagan, right? This is about, what, 5 or 6 years after his first overthrow.
No, I think his first overthrow was in like the 1950s.
I'm seeing on Wikipedia that it was like 1964. Unless, oh, no, yeah, wait, you're right. That was when he was the chief minister. Okay, never mind.
Chetty has a ridiculous... Like
he gets Chetty has thrown like multiple times.
Yeah, exactly. Even I think in like the 1990s, they were like is when they like apologized to him. Yeah, so he was the chief minister of British Guyana in 1953, and yeah.
Just in case you forgot,
we covered this when we went over Killing Hope. And we may watch a documentary on Friday about Guyana and during its colonial period, which during like the sugar plantations, and it's really fucked up. But yeah, we may watch that on Friday. It's a really cool documentary with a lot of really cool music in it.
So just to remind you, chat, we have gone over Guyana and politics before, or is it Guyanese? Whatever.
Guyanese, yeah, I believe so.
All right.
Who stand on this platform can tell you that the remedy in Guyana is that a new set of people must take over from the old set of people. And we will run the system better. That is no solution to the problems of Guyana. The problem is much more fundamental than that. We are saying that working class people will get just only when they take the initiative, when they move themselves. Nobody else can give it as a gift. Someone who comes claiming to be a liberator is either deluding himself or is trying to delude the people. He either doesn't understand the process of real life, or he is trying to suggest that you do not understand it. And so long as we suffer from a warped concept of politics as being leadership, we are going to be in a lot of trouble.
Is it, remember, I don't know if you paid it, this is all his funeral. This is the, when Walter Rodney was assassinated, this is the funeral.
In our society at the present time, some specific rights which had been won through struggle by the people in the colonial period are now in the process of being eroded. One takes the most obvious, the electoral process. In Guyana, it is now, I think, widely known inside the country and outside of the country that first of all, the Americans intervened along with the British to abort the democratic process from 1953 onwards, and secondly, that once the present government got into power, it extended the scale of electoral fraud so that we cannot claim at the present time to be a politically enfranchised people. We cannot claim to have chosen our own national government. And that is one level. Below that level, you find that there is reproduced in every facet of the national life the same anti-democratic tendencies. So that there are no local government elections, for instance. They have local government elections that are postponed every time they become due with ease, with no concern whatsoever, with no reaction. There are no elections taking place within certain trade unions, where workers at that basic level should be choosing their representatives to deal with their material interests. And once that anti-democratic principle is established, we see then step by step we move backwards. And I say backwards very deliberately. These were not rights or privileges which were handed to us by the British. The right to have your union and to have a democratic union was won through struggle in this very century. The right to have democratic elections was won only in the late 1940s and in 1953 when there was universal adult suffrage. So that these recently conquered rights are now in the process of being withheld, eroded, dissipated in one form or fashion. In the early years of independence, or the last years of colonialism, we had certain illusions that having inherited the formal modes of political procedure from the British, that of necessity we would not follow the paths that had been followed by other Latin American territories or by countries such as Haiti, Underdeveloped, and the Dominican Republic and Cuba and the like. And as people begin to recognize that many of these authoritarian traits and repressive institutions can and are emerging in our society, I feel that there is a growing awareness of the need to attempt to combat this repression. One of the significant areas in which repression is taking place is the whole area of the media, the newspapers and the radios. We find that since the government has taken over the papers, it has ostensibly nationalized these newspapers, meaning in the interest of the nation, but in practice it is specifically in the interest of the ruling party.
Lenin, thank you
As
so much.
The Prime Minister of this country himself once cynically remarked, he says, the government never tells the newspapers what to print. They simply tell them what not to print. And then they go beyond that. They're not prepared to allow competing centers of information so that they utilize illegal machinery to crush things like the Mirror, the People's Progressive Party's newspaper, the Day Clean, which is a new sheet printed by the Working People's Alliance. They had made it impossible for a political organization to print a newspaper. That organization then resorted to mimeographing a sheet, but the government considered it absolutely essential to continue to persecute, to go to the level of seizing typewriters to make it impossible for people to type and produce a mimeograph sheet. The point is that elements that clearly purport to be anti-socialist are not pursued in the society with the same vigor. So it indicates the direction of the attack that is being borne by the government. It's not against reactionary elements, it's not against imperialist elements, it's really against anti-imperialist and progressive forces. In Guyana, when we speak of civil liberties and civil rights, people are beginning to understand that the most fundamental of these is the right to work in our society. And what is occurring in Guyana is that the government is making political capital out of the indefensible position of one who is either unemployed or is very close to the line of being unemployed. Guyana is a small country. We have to be realistic about that. It means that if you're unemployed in one area, you don't sort of leave the East Coast and go and get a job on the West Coast, or leave the North and get a job in the South. You don't leave one industrial occupation and get a job in another. To be excluded from one specific area of employment often means total exclusion from the employment market. And since the government itself has taken over so many facets of economic life, has nationalized the bauxite, has nationalized sugar, has nationalized a number of private firms, justifiably so, it has taken up a position as the principal, far and away the largest single employer in the country. Consequently, the ground is really set for the utilization of this device of the party card, of political control by means of denying the right to work. And it is a frightening situation in its own right, because in all reality, it is unnecessary to threaten a man's life and liberty if by the fundamental threat to his capacity to earn and survive, you can reduce him to a state of submission. And this is continually what is taking place. It does
Man,
not
it,
appear
and speaking is incredible.
To be as frightening as the overt exploitation and oppression of the South African prisoners, or the Chilean torture cells, or the Brazilian torture cells. But from the viewpoint of the mass of the population in the country and their capacity to express themselves politically, this denial of the right to work is a new frightening dimension of our political scene. Even as a critic of the government of this country, myself and others in the Working People's Alliance would not expect that the economy automatically would transform itself from a colonial economy, from a dependent economy, to an independent, functioning, socialist, integrated economy. We do not expect this because we understand the dynamics of the international capitalist system into which we are caught up. Many people are, of course, fully aware that Guyana has made claims to having broken with imperialism, or having the intention even of breaking with imperialism. What we find in our actual economic relationship is a very marginal shift for the sake of convenience towards an expansion of trade with socialist countries and a nominal takeover of large sectors of the economy, but not based on a firm commitment to break the ties by which our working class was continually exporting surplus to foreign capital. Consequently, at the last budget, it was evident that the rate of repayment of interest, as well as the actual payments for nationalization, was so high that it constituted the same drain, if not greater, than it was in the period of direct foreign ownership. This is the sort of contradiction in which we find ourselves, partly because of historical forces, but also because the class in power doesn't have a conception of where it is going, how it will extricate itself from certain relationships, and indeed one wonders whether fundamentally the petty bourgeois class really has a commitment to extricate itself from international capital.
Food plenty in the market to kill GMC dumping. Money not ever buy because you're poor like me, you're black like me, and poverty is your legacy. Last election was 64. From since then was selection, that's all about corruption. Poor like me, you're black like me, and poverty is your legacy. Yet we have democracy and can't do nothing. We have neither the power nor capacity. Code of Conduct Act, start cut down corruption trees, limo fall, rubber job, libel, scandal, day clean in court, mirror in court, UC in jail, can't get so big. So, funny man, buck man, black man, Chinese man, bury the axe. Renounce starvation, renounce corruption, announce revolution. Cause you're poor like me, you're black like me, and poverty is your letter. Has put the whole nation in a position in which it has to pay in order that foreign capital or foreign multinational interests should still continue to draw surplus from our economy in indirect means.
But having put the whole nation in hock, as it were, the government goes further. It makes certain distinctions which allow a small segment of the population to pass the real burden down to the vast majority of the direct producers. The key question then, is there any basis for suggesting that the working people themselves are now either in greater control of the processes, or are they in a better position to recoup for themselves the product of their own labor? And I would suggest that the answer to that is a negative, and that is the answer which workers give. This is the answer which bauxite workers are giving. This is the answer which sugar workers are giving. And the record is clear in terms of the actions which these workers themselves are taking. We then have to ask, is it that the entire Guyanese nation bears the strain? Or isn't it that a particular segment of the population is itself in a position to pass the burden down to the vast majority? They do so in terms of their high salaries. They do so in terms of various quasi-legal and illegal manipulations, either in direct control of the economy or sometimes in conjunction with the small private capitalist sector which exists. The well-known tale of the rake-offs and the like. Okay. So the political elite ensures that they do not suffer from the pressure which is brought to bear on the nation as a whole. And this is again where the class question comes to the fore. Economic crisis can always be measured in terms of statistical indices. But more important still, people in their day-to-day lives will know what it means to be living in a period of economic crisis. The people will know, the housewives will know what happens to be the price of goods in the shop at a given moment. They will know what items are short. They will know how difficult it is to move from one point to another because there is no public transportation or because it is entirely inadequate. And it is really these things that surround and dictate the lives of people. The fact of having to get up at 4 a.m. in the morning to get to work at 8, not because of any great distance, but because of a totally inadequate transportation system. The fact of leaving work in the afternoon and not getting home until the night, precisely because of that same transportation system. It seems to me that in many respects, the working people of the country are showing by their actions and showing by their day-to-day utterances their awareness of the way in which all these indices are real to them in a day-to-day sense. Their children show it in terms of malnutrition. Their old people show it in terms of inadequate medical attention. And one really doesn't say that this is a unique situation. It is found in so many parts of the third world. What makes it in a sense unique is that we are speaking in a political context in which the regime in power makes certain claims, claims to egalitarianism, claims to justice, produces the very fancy brochures which would suggest that there is no such thing as malnutrition, that there is no such thing as starvation, debilitation, shortages, and the like, when a glance at the country, as it were, a reference to the living experience of people would show all of this to be false. The crux of the matter is this. The Guyana economy is in crisis. But over and beyond that, the working people are in the greatest financial and economic strait because the burden of oppression is constantly shifted down onto the shoulders of the working people. Guyana is known internationally as a place in which racial strife has taken place. Community violence reached a particular pitch. One of the few third world countries that we associate with racial violence between two non-white peoples. And of course, the government in power claims that since they came to power, since the PNC came to power, racialism has more or less been dismissed in Guyana. The problem has been resolved. The Working People's Alliance challenges that position. We say that far from being resolved, racism has simply been manipulated by the party in power, and that it is absolutely essential for the well-being of the nation as a symbolic entity, and more particularly for the well-being of the working people as real living beings, that we should address ourselves to the problem of race, and that we should transcend rather than ignore the problem of race. The regime simply goes around papering over cracks, posturing, presenting public positions which claim that there is no racial oppression, that there is no racial discrimination, that there is no sense of racism in the way in which they operate the economy. But in actual fact, they play upon the fears of the Afro-Guyanese masses, they exacerbate the fears of the Indo-Guyanese masses, and in everyday affairs, the manipulation of the courts, the question of granting employment, the structure of the national service, the employment in public services and in all of the armed services, in all of these areas of the national life, they are day-to-day incidents where people of one race or another have cause to feel fear. The Working People's Alliance sees it as one of the principal tasks of our generation, perhaps the most overriding task, to break the division in the ranks of the working class, to overcome that division, to create a unity based on struggle, not a hypothetical unity, not a theoretical unity, but a unity based on struggle, a unity arising out of the fact that workers who are African in origin or Indian in origin, at their place of work, in their places of residence, will struggle for their own material and cultural rewards, and in so doing, come to a sense of the necessary unity required to achieve their objectives.
How much is left on the video?
About 4 minutes?
I didn't, you know, we've maintained most of our audience through this. I thought it was important to learn
seen,
about
that. I think some evidence of this. We have
We'll let it run. We'll just let it run through. There's only a few minutes left.
Okay.
Seen workers in the bauxite sector coming to an awareness over the years that although they're predominantly African, their principal opponents by no means could be construed to be the Indian workers. On the contrary, that they should call upon the Indian workers to side with them in confrontation with the petty bourgeoisie, even when that petty bourgeoisie is predominantly African. We have seen Indian workers, I think, in recent years becoming more aware of the fact that their predicament is not simply because they are Indians or even because they are sugar workers, but because they are workers and they are faced with an exploitative machinery which includes Indian merchants who will establish liaisons and links with the African petty bourgeoisie in order to ensure that the surplus produced in sugar goes into hands other than that of the workers themselves.
Thank you, Tay.
My own awareness of the history of Guyana in the colonial period is that the colonial regime trembled whenever African and Indian workers moved together. And on the basis of that and many other facts which can be adduced, I would say that when African and Indian workers move together, the local exploiting class will have a very short lease of life. Thank you.
You know, look, you don't have to wish, Robbo. You know, this is something that we can all ourselves create, okay? And it's on us to create that sense where we are. You know what I mean?
Yeah, and man, I mean, like, honestly, I was like, I don't know if we're going to get through this whole video, but I feel like Walter Rodney's speaking is so lucid and like captivating that like I thought we were like halfway through it, and then like I was like, oh, it's over. Holy shit. But you know, we're talking about Walter Rodney. Everybody talks about him. Everybody talks about greatest, you know, let's sit and fucking listen to him for a second. You know what I mean? Like, you know, we're going to read him, but like, let's see not only, you know, who he was, what he said, what he sounded like, but like, what are the conditions that create him? What is the Guyanese society that produced this? What were the inequalities and repression that kind of caused this? And on Friday, I have a plan that if nothing else happens, like, I don't know who's coming on or what, but I have a documentary about Guyana that's really, really cool and has a lot of really awesome music interludes in it that I like quite a bit. So if you're going to hang out on Friday, we may go through that somewhat longer documentary about Guyana. Guyana's kind of like a weird overlooked history, right? Like, I feel like it doesn't get talked about that often. It kind of like strangely exists in the periphery of the Caribbean and South America in a way that I feel like it kind of gets overshadowed by a lot of other historical and revolutionary movements that we associate with those areas. But it seems like there's such like a rich history there that's interesting to learn about.
Oh, yeah. And like, remember when we learned that, like, wait, there's like a huge Indian population there, like Indian
right,
population yeah. there. I was like, okay, I wasn't aware of that. I know that
Chetty was in India, and the reason that is because it was a British colony, and British people would essentially take indentured servants from the Indian subcontinent, which was also a colony at the time, and bring them to Guyana to work on sugar plantations.
Yeah. Is this one you or me? I have completely forgotten who read last.
I'll take it. Don't worry about it. So, continuing with this introduction. Hard as his death is to accept and absorb, we must begin here, not primarily for purpose of sentiment or political incentive, but because no new introduction to how Europe underdeveloped Africa is possible without a serious and direct encounter with Walter Rodney, the revolutionary scholar, the scholar revolutionary, the man of great integrity and hope. For more so than most books of its genre, this work is clearly imbued with the spirit, the intellect, and the commitment of its author, both the man who produced the audacious and wide-ranging study before he was 30, and the man who moved with the unswerving integrity to live out its implications in his relatively brief years. With Rodney, the life and the work were one, and the life drives us back to recall the essential themes of the work. In spite of its title, this is not simply a work about European oppressors and African victims, serving primarily as a weapon to flay the exploiters and beat them at their own intellectual game. Of course, it has done yeoman service in that limited role. Rather, there is much more to this masterly survey, and at its deepest levels, it offers no easy comfort to any of us.
I need to Google the term yeoman.
Yeah, it's weird because yeoman, I think that's actually a term that's used in Korea.
A man holding and cultivating a small landed estate, a freeholder, a servant in a royal or noble household, ranking between a sergeant and a groom, or a squire and a page.
Interesting. It used to be a guy and a streamer on Twitch. Oh, interesting.
What is the difference between a yeoman and a serf? A peasant might be a serf bound to stay on their lord's estate, unable to leave without his permission, and bound to offer labor, service, or a franklin? What? That is a free man.
Give me your franklin.
Sure. What's a fucking franklin? That is a free man, but still a tenant of a lord and working on his manor. A yeoman was a man who owned and worked his own land and was nobody's tenant. This is during the medieval period. Yeoman is a noun, one who owns and cultivates his own land, or the middle ranks of servants in an English royal or noble household. The term was first documented in the 14th century England. All right. Well, you know, new word just dropped. Okay.
Yep. Get ready. Get ready for the yeoman arc of subversive history.
Right, we're going to make that one of the tiers when we start making tiers on Patreon. Yeah, it's just above surf, you know? Yeah. We're going to have surf at like $1 to $2, maybe make the $5 one of the Yao Man, you know? sure if we can figure out what's above a Yao man, you know, other than a noble or a lord, you know.
Landed well, gentry.
Yeah, landed gentry.
Propertyed class.
Yeah. So at one point, early in the book, Rodney summarizes its basic message. All right, keep your ears open, chat. This is the basic message of the book. The question as to who and what is responsible for African development can be answered at two levels. Firstly, the answer is that the operation of the imperialist system bears major responsibility for African economic retardation by draining African wealth and by making it impossible to develop more rapidly the resources of the continent. Secondly, one has to deal with those who manipulated the system and those who are either agents or unwitting accomplices of the said system. The capitalists of Western Europe were the ones who actively extended their exploitation from inside Europe to cover the whole of Africa. In recent times, they were joined and to some extent replaced by the capitalists from the United States. And for many years now, even the workers of those metropolitan countries have benefited from the exploitation and underdevelopment of Africa. What? What do you mean rule violation? What did I do? What?
You said retardation.
It's in the book.
I know. And also, there, I don't think there's anything wrong with using it in its like official, like in a more like official sense, like we're talking about an economy.
Are we also canceling Walter Rodney?
They're just playing around.
Okay.
They're having a little laugh in chat, and that's okay.
But I think what he's getting at is, like, you know, we all have iPhone because, yeah, like, you know, we just brutally repress and, you know, exploit Africa.
Correct.
Oh, my get them is for the Europeans. Oh, okay. Yeah, all right. Yeah, sure. Let's see what Norm Finkelstein thinks about.
Can you bring in Norm, please? All right.
Let's not.
So, all this Walter supported with a profuse and creative set of precise examples from many sources, periods, and places. Yet, he was not satisfied to pour well-documented blows upon the oppressors, though he was a master at this activity. Nor did it suffice to remind many of us who live in the United States that our blackness provides no, or, you know, not mine, but that our blackness provides no exemption from our willing participation in the benefits of our country's exploitation of Africa. Rather, this summary of the book's central theme includes with words that moved beyond accusation or guilt. He said, "None of these remarks are intended to remove the ultimate responsibility for development from the shoulders of Africans. Not only are there African accomplices inside the imperialist system, but every African has a responsibility to understand the system and work for its overthrow." Unlike many of us who read and write such words, Walter took them seriously. He knew that they were meant for him, for the children of Africa and the Caribbean and the United States of America, for Indians, Asians, and many other sufferers at the hands of European-fueled underdevelopment. Indeed, he knew they were meant, too, for all those Europeans and Americans who claimed solidarity with the Third World struggle for development and liberation.
Right, I feel like he's touching on a very sensitive topic, right?
But he's saying it in a way that's extremely, like, when he's saying that the blame lies on Africans, he's saying that we all need to I'm speaking from his perspective, and that's insensitive of me, that everyone that's involved as a victim of that, they have a responsibility to learn it and overthrow it. If you don't learn it and overthrow it, then you're, like, in some ways just as complicit as those that are perpetuating it.
Right. And this is why, you know, especially when it comes to the topic of being a settler, right? There's a lot of white, pale-faced leftists that are like, I don't want to be this immutable bad thing, right, that is a settler. And it's like, well, there's nothing you can do about that. But it is your responsibility as a settler, right, for you to do what you can to educate yourself. And then once you are educated, right, and you have done the investigation, right, of the colonialism and imperialism that has gone on, like within where you reside and what you benefit from, do what you can, right, within your ability to end it, right? You can also be blind to that complicity, but I struggle to find a top-earning black capitalist who isn't just demonstrably an awful person in or out of the U.S.
I will, not that I don't disagree, don't agree, but that is, you know.
Again, not our place.
Exactly. But also, this is part of the reason why there was once a discussion for us to read Frantz Fanon, you know, white, black skin, white mask. And I didn't feel comfortable as like two white guys, like having a stream where it's just like, now let's talk about what it's like to be black for a while here. Let's like, right. You know what I mean? Like, let's pontificate about what Mr. Fanon meant about the black experience and what this is like and what colonialism has done to the black. Like,
right.
It just seemed a little bit.
We are a
inappropriate.
Right. We are a show that is painfully aware of our limitations. Right.
So we try to platform, like, this is why we're reading Walter Rodney. You know what I mean? So that we right. can be like, here's this thing, you know, if you're going to listen to us, at least we're going to fucking shed light on like the real shit that's going to bring you to some level of enlightenment on this.
Right. Finally, a stream that has whites expressing the black experience. And it's like, you know, I'm sure there are, you know, people in chat, right, that or other people that would say, oh, why don't you just invite, you know, like a someone right of that community on, and it feels kind of tokenizing if we were to do something like that, you know.
But also, it's hard to get somebody to do this. That what we do,
right? Like, you understand? Like, Pat's streaming right now on his fucking birthday. Okay, like I don't know if there are that many people that are like, yeah, I'm gonna commit like at least 3 days out of the fucking week. Can we unmod?
If only you had one black friend to help you unpack. If only you had one black friend.
Look, we both do have black friends, okay? Right? That's not the point. That's not even what I was getting at. I don't know. Like, chat, you're fucking me up here, okay? That's what you're doing. Name them?
Name them.
Well, there's you, Wilco. I'd start with you right there. You're my number one pick, you know? We should just have you on here 3 days out of the week.
I mean, I wouldn't say no to anybody that wanted to come on and talk about our chapter with us.
Name all of the black
Ashkosh, thank you so much. And also, Lennon, thank you so much for the birthday wishes. I appreciate you guys.
So I think, what, is this me? No, this one's you, yeah.
No, this is you. I just read that last one. Or go back. No, maybe you're right.
Yeah.
Go back. No, this one's you, yeah.
Oh, it is me? Okay. So, Rodney envisioned and worked on the assumption that the new development of Africans and other dependent peoples of the periphery would require what he called a radical break with the international capitalist system, a courageous challenge to the failing center of the current world order. Of course, he also knew that any such break or serious contestation would participate in and precipitate profound revolutionary changes at the center itself. Thus, from his perspective, what was ultimately at stake, what was absolutely necessary, was a fundamental transformation in the ordering of the political, cultural, and economic forces that have dominated the world for almost half a millennium. This was an awesome vision, especially since Walter dared to say and believe that such a stupendous transformation must be initiated by Africans and other dwellers in the nether regions of exploitation and subordination. Nevertheless, he did not flinch from the implication of his own analysis. Instead, he continued, especially by his example, to encourage all of us to move toward a radically transformed vision of ourselves and of our capacities for changing our lives and our objective conditions. Quietly, insistently, he urged us to claim our full responsibility for engaging in the struggle for a new world order.
good. I think there's a video next.
Is something happening in chat? What? There was like a lot of stuff happening. And like...
Nothing really happened.
Okay. It's just Wilco trying to have like a battle royale in chat.
Oh. Sounds like a spicy interaction, bup.
Oh, Wilco gave me the talk one day. He had a shitty interaction with his twink trying to advocate about FBI statistics on... Oh my god. You know, I just... I completely just deleted somebody that I knew for a long time. A white cis gay man. That, like, you know, I have literally seen in a face-to-face interaction with a black person he has never met before, this is at a meeting, say that he does not see color. And I...
achievement of white non-racism, by the way.
Right.
Brother, I don't see color. I don't care if you're purple.
He literally what? Said that. and then today I see that I haven't really talked to him, but I saw that he posted, like, I stand with Israel, and I'm like, I know for a fact you're a fucking moron and that you have read literally nothing about this, so you know what, I'm over trying to act as if like we're still friends or have anything in common, or that you don't aggravate the living shit out of me. Also, chat, quick story. Okay. Quick okay. story. Mm-hmm. Okay, so like before, like, me and, you know, my current wife started dating, right? He thought he had a shot, right? Here's the thing. He wore an X-Men belt buckle, right? And I had to explain to him.
Save some pussy for the rest of us, right? You know what
I
mean? Like,
I had to explain to him, right? Look, bud, you never had a fucking shot, all right? You're a gigantic fucking nerd, and like, it was never
cool,
gonna
not like a cool nerd.
Right,
like,
no, I'm into X-Men and shit like that. Like, I'll watch anime and shit, but you're like a fucking nerd about it. And like, I just, yeah, toxic. I know. I know. you literally have the Targaryen coat of arms tattooed on your bicep. I would never, ever, ever want to be seen in public with you. Right, and have to introduce you as my partner, right? This is my boyfriend. He's got, yeah, I know, he's got a Game of Thrones tattoo. Yeah, but no, never gonna happen.
Which one were the Targaryens?
The incestuous white haired people.
Why would you get the tattoo of that one?
Because they have the dragons.
So if you got the dragons, you got the juice.
Imagine unbuckling that X-Men belt buckle.
So it also, I mean, I don't need to say this to anyone in this chat, but the concept of black on black crime is just so, the framing of it is so stupid and racist, right? As if all crime is not overwhelmingly intra-racial in nature.
Right.
It doesn't matter what demographic you're looking at. If you were looking at crime where there is a victim and a assailant, it is so disproportionately intra-racial that to point at black on black crime and say that this is some kind of like a exceptional type of situation, the only reason that you would frame it like that is because you are just blinded by prejudice.
Right. And that, and like, that's to ignore, like, you know, the what's the word? Oh, apartheid state that we live in, where you know, populations of people have been separated, and you know, there's this thing called redlining of districts where, you know, certain populations aren't allowed to move in or out of certain spaces within the U.S. right? Which kind of creates that sort of, like, you know, well, yeah, or what? I'm just gonna play the video.
Negative attitude towards Africa. In San Francisco, on African Liberation Day, Brother Walter Rodney, an African historian, noted both the importance of African Liberation Day in terms of our African identity and some of the root causes for our problem of identification.
I have met brothers and sisters who say that their mother tongue, quote unquote, is French, Spanish, Dutch, Portuguese, as well as English, which we speak. And because of this, we have a problem of identification. We do not know whom we are. And that is why this gathering is of great symbolic importance, because it is an act of identification. We are saying that we identify with the African people of the African continent. We are saying that we are an African people. And when we make this identification, have no illusions about the fact that this is a very revolutionary initiative. It is a rejection of every other form of identification which the white society has asked us to accept. Let me draw your attention to something which white universities and white libraries practice. And this is a university community. Numerous universities lie around this land. Go into their libraries and check the Library of Congress cards under Europe or European. You will find all entries listed concerning the continent of Europe. You will also find entries listed about Europeans in East Africa, Europeans in North Africa, Europeans in Asia and Australia. Look under the Chinese. You will find entries listed not only for mainland China, but for Malaysia and for the Chinese in North America. But look on the Africa and the Africans, the only entries on the Africans relate to the continent itself. There are no entries on the Africans overseas. There is no such category. Africans who have been raped from the continent mysteriously disappear and become Negroes.
I have nothing to add.
There's nothing really for me to add to that, because like when talking, this is why I'm just trying to like put the videos in there, like, because this kind of introduction is written by black people regarding Walter Rodney and how that affects like their experience as a black person. So there's only so much I'm going to pontificate on that, and we can put a video of Rodney, you know, speaking about it. Yeah, no notes.
No notes. Also, Ninja Can, were you trying to do like the X-Men theme, but through like na 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 na? Is that what you were doing? Is this one you or me?
This one is me.
Okay.
So, no one could ignore Walter Rodney's work, nor question his call. For he set the example by assuming his own part of the awesome responsibility. That is why he was in Guyana in June 1980. That is why he had been there since 1974, developing the leadership of what was called the Working People's Alliance. Struggling to support his family, somehow finding time to carry on research and writing on the history of the working people of his country and other parts of the Caribbean, that is why he was murdered. In the midst of our sorrow and indignation, none of us who knew Walter could honestly say that we were surprised by the news of his death, for his life carried a certain consistency and integrity that could not be ignored or denied. Indeed, in his relatively brief time, certain patterns were established early. Born on March 23, 1942, Rodney grew up in Georgetown, the capital of what was then British Guyana. From the outset, he was part of a family that took transformational politics with great seriousness. His parents, especially his father, were deeply involved in the development of the People's Progressive Party. A multiracial party, it was at the time the only mass political organization in the Caribbean that was opening the common people to the world of Marxist/socialist thought, as well as raising the possibilities of alternative futures that might go beyond the mere establishment of independence within the British Commonwealth. I assume that this was during the time of Chetty, if I'm not mistaken, yeah.
Also, shout out to Walter Rodney's dad being like one of the few fucking Marxists like that raised kids that turned out like halfway decent. I'm sorry. It's just like, you know, every single like, you know, Marxist parent or like, you know, notable, like really famous piece of shit. It's like, oh, yeah, their dad was like, you know, Yeah, Kamala comes to mind. Booty Giggle comes to mind. I'm trying to think of another one. It's probably more, right? But those are just the top two in my head, at least in America. We're batting like
people against their parents, you know.
And also tend to be of marginalized origins. Shout out Walter Rodney's dad. Exactly. Yeah. Yeah, I said Mayo Pete. Pete Booty Giggle. Oh, wait, that's what's missing. My smooth jazz. Also, chat, like, you know, let me know, like, if you want me to start. So long as it's, like, got no words and it's mostly just, like, you know, music, right? And it's kind of, like, calm, right? Let me know what you want me to put on, right? Because, you know, the Blue Note Jazz, you know, playlist. I'm sure you're all getting tired of, you know, hearing the same artist. So even before he entered his teens, Walter was already engaged in leafleting, attending party meetings, and absorbing the thousands of hours of political discussions that went on in his home. Then, when he entered Queens College, the highly regarded secondary school in Georgetown, the young political activist also became one of the scholarship boys, so familiar to West Indian life at the time. Bright, energetic, and articulate, he excelled in academics and sports. He broke his school record for the high jump. And when he won the coveted Guyana scholarship to the University College of the West Indies at Mona, Jamaica, the traditional path to academic prestige and distinction was open to him. In 1963, Rodney graduated with first-class honors in history from UCWI and was awarded a scholarship to the University of London, where he entered the School of Oriental and African Studies, canceled, to work on his doctorate in African history. Walter's political instincts and early nurturing would not allow him to settle into the safety of conventional academic life. Instead, the years in London, 1963 to 1966, were among the most important of his continuing political and intellectual development. He immediately became part of a study group of younger West Indians who met regularly under the guidance of the man who was the exemplar of the revolutionary intellectual, C.L.R. James, the Trinidadian Marxist scholar best known for his history of the Haitian Revolution, Black Jacobins.
So, in my opinion, this is required leftist reading. You know, if you want to know about Toussaint Louverture, you want to know about the Haitian Revolution, you want to learn about imperialism, deep imperialism, hundreds of years, years ago, you should read the Black Jacobins. Now, with that being said, we're going to watch two short videos about C.L.R. James, and I need everybody to put on their big person pants, and I need everybody to be okay with potentially this revolutionary, this Marxist scholar of the colonial Caribbean, potentially not saying some...
Might have some words, all right?
Might have some words about certain political leaders that you might be favorable to. So let's...
Okay.
And also, this is a Michael... The first one is from the Michael Brooks show. There's... C.L.R. James is like a little bit obscured. There's not a ton of videos about him, but Michael Brooks did like a short video on him. And in terms of something that can fit into this, this worked kind of well. So...
Rest in peace, Michael Brooks. Yeah, rest in peace, Michael Brooks. I need to get back on the treadmill. I'm not doing it as regularly as I was a while ago, but I also felt like it was kind of distracting, so I don't know.
Haiti recently marked its Independence Day. We've covered a lot on this show. It's the 216th anniversary of an incredible place. I mean, literally a country born of a slave revolt. And really, like, as Zizek and I were talking about, like the fullest expression of the ideals of the French Revolution. The only reason it goes from a provincial event a global one is because of what the Haitians achieved. And the Western world, colonialist world, France, the United States, Canada, have been punishing them ever since. But even as we speak, and we've covered this on the show as well, there's still an ongoing uprising in Haiti, and it is one of the core of the world today. But I wanted to play a little bit of this. Everybody, I really do think C.L.R. James' Black Jacobins is really one of the most important books you can read.
You can download it, the PDF for free online, too.
Yes, it's super accessible. And this is a conversation that with Stuart Hall, who we played recently on the show as well, had with C.L.R. James on Black Jacobins in 1986. Jacobin posted this on their YouTube channel. And we're just going to play this and reflect a little bit on the anniversary and then go on.
I mean, people now talk about Black Jacobins as an important historical book, but really, it was also a thesis about contemporary black politics, wasn't it?
It was, and politics that is fundamental is always applicable to different periods of history, because fundamental politics always has behind it the struggle of different classes. Different sections of the class can struggle and kill one another, but that is not much a social event as when one social structure is fighting against another part of the social structure. Certain logical and historical things emerge which are applicable to similar periods, 1,000 years before or after.
But what is the significance of Toussaint Louverture for you? I mean, how do you see the connection between those events in Haiti then and the 20th century politics?
I have already said during the last few minutes that any great revolutionary event in history, from it you can always find principles and historical movement ideas that are applied to others. I was saying that before. Now, that is so in any great revolution, and the San Domingo Revolution was the first great revolution of black people. Now, when you consider the role that Africa was going to play in the world in the years to come, that then acquires a significance. Furthermore, it was a part of the French Revolution. So that you have in that historical event a duality in which it takes part in the great revolutions is very important. The first was the British, and at the same time it points the finger to the revolutions among colonial peoples, so that that revolution is something that is worthy of consideration by every type of historian.
I would just really recommend you read that book.
It's a great book.
Yeah. You just watched a Michael Brooks Show video. Subscribe to get them all. Why wouldn't you? Don't be foolish.
Why wouldn't you? Why
click
wouldn't
subscribe you? Below and become a patron as well. Patreon.com/TM.
Also, I accidentally opened the message, but Tay sent a little link ski in the wispy.
Oh, did they?
I do miss Michael for sure. You know, honestly, the reason that I bought the book, the reason I bought the book, Neo-Colonialism, the Highest Stage of Imperialism, which is Kwame Nkrumah's book, which is kind of like an extension to the, you know, Lenin book, Imperialism, the Highest Stage of Capitalism, is because Michael Brooks had this person on. His name was Milton. I forget his last name. He's an African, not sure if he's a historian or a philosopher or an economist, but it's the first person I heard talk about that, and that's when I bought the book. This was probably in 2020.
In the before four time.
Yeah. Second little one, it's called this is from a very small channel. Like I said, there's not a ton about C.L.R. James. So it's a little biographical one. I need everybody to buckle up for this and, you know, you'll get through it.
Lionel Robert James was born on January 4th, 1901 in Chaguanas, Trinidad. His dad was a teacher, and so James had a heavy influence from education as a child. Unlike the Reconstruction era in the United States, where a lot of white teachers came to uplift formerly enslaved black communities out of poverty, in Trinidad, a lot of education was focused on English history and...
Am I wrong, or is like Reconstruction in America generally viewed as like a failure?
Oh, it was. whether it's viewed as a failure or not, it was an abject failure.
Right. But, and I believe that this was the writing that W.E.B. Du Bois wrote about. One of his most famous works was regarding Reconstruction.
Yeah.
But did you hear what they said there? They said that teachers helped lift black communities out of poverty. Could you just replay that part for me?
Surely.
Reconstruction era, and so James had a heavy influence from education as a child. Unlike the Reconstruction era in the United States, where a lot of white teachers came to uplift formerly enslaved black communities out of poverty, in Trinidad, a lot of education was focused on English history and English values. As a young adult, James spent the majority of his time writing, teaching, and playing cricket. In 1932, James moved to England to focus on his writing career. During his time there, he wrote his three-act play, Toussaint L'Ouverture, and several articles on politics, cricket, and the inner...
Did you catch who that was?
No. Was it Robeson?
His three-act play, Toussaint L'Ouverture...
It is Robeson. God, what a beautiful man.
Is it?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's gotta be, right?
Chat, can you check our racism, please? Wilco, Tay, can you check my racism? Is that Paul Robeson?
Are we being racist right now?
That looks like a young Paul. that looks like a young Paul, if I ever saw one. Let me see. Paul Robeson, Toussaint L'Ouverture. It says he played.
All right,
yeah.
Okay, thank God. also, Robbo, cricket is wildly...
Loved cricket. Can you go back like 10 seconds? It's going to talk. Apparently, one of his first things that he ever wrote about was like how radical politics and cricket like interact.
That's wild.
Majority of his time writing, teaching, and playing cricket. In 1932, James moved to England to focus on his writing career. During his time there, he wrote his three-act play, Toussaint L'Ouverture, and several articles on politics, cricket, and the intersections between sports, culture, and social and racial issues. During his time in.
Like.
Dude loves cricket.
And the intersections between sports, culture, and social and...
that is not CLR, James. That is fucking Muhammad Ali.
Yeah. But it's like, to be like, well, I love, you know, politics and class issues, and I love cricket.
I'm going to combine the two.
I'm going to write it, yeah.
But I feel like, is there like a heavy like Indian like population in Trinidad?
I'm not sure. I definitely don't know enough about Trinidad.
Because I know that, like, yeah, fucking, like, I lived in, like, an apartment that had, like, a very big Indian population at one point, and in, like, the little courtyard area, they would play cricket in the summertime, and I was like, this is the first time in my life I'm watching people in meat space.
I imagine that Trinidad, if cricket's popular there, I wouldn't be surprised if there was a significant Indian population. I think that might be why those two things are connected like that.
Right. Like outside of England, I can't think of any other like group of people that love cricket besides India. Yeah.
When I was in India, I was with my friend. He was like watching it. Like there was like a really big game. I don't know what their World Series would be called or whatever, but they were watching it. It was pretty cool.
Well, do you remember during COVID where there was like this like Indian village that had set up like fake cricket games, and people were so bored during COVID that they were betting on fake cricket games that like they had rigged it, and like it was amazing. I got to see if I can like find an article or something about it, but yeah, like people like in England and like, you know, abroad were betting on like fake cricket games that this Indian village had set up. Yeah. So I need to finish that book. Penny Lee Joseph's The Third Reconstruction, America's Struggle for Racial Justice, where he argues we are undergoing another reconstruction that might spell our doom. Well,
we love some Peniel over here at Subversive History. Yeah. I do love me some Peniel.
I actually would love to interview him because he was on what the hell is it?
Malcolm X documentary. The Malcolm X documentary about Malcolm X's murder. That like didn't Netflix or somebody?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Also, he was on C-SPAN, and some white lady asked him, "You sound like a Marxism or something," and he just like did. He just like no reaction to it. Loved it. I don't know. I gotta see if I can find
how well spoken he was.
I think somebody did say that, you know, you're so well spoken for
what you are.
I mean, it's C-SPAN, so it's just like, you know.
Yeah, but that's like the giveaway that they're like, but you're so well spoken. Like, why you seem like such a nice
And you know, I forget who was.
To my complete surprise, you know,
it might have been Piss Drinker, but then again, it also might have been Pedro. And I feel like if it was Pedro, he probably would have like said something racist to him himself. But I can't remember. So, anyways, I want the CLR James
racial issue. During his time in England, he would study the works of Marx, Lenin, Engels, and Trotsky, and merged his interest in black politics with Marxist theory. James, notably, was not a Stalinist. He found Stalinism to be a kind of totalitarianism with qualities shared by all other authoritarian regimes, whether democratic, fascist, or communist. From 1935 to 1938, James would spend a lot of his time establishing and working with various Marxist and Trotskyist organizations. James's fascination and appreciation for Haitian revolutionary Toussaint Louverture found relatively widespread notoriety after he published The Black Jacobins, his second play about the famous slave uprising in 1938. That same year, he would travel the United States on a lecture tour, staying until the 1950s when McCarthyism forced him to leave the country. In 1939, toward the beginning of his U.S. tour, James met Leon Trotsky and spent some time at his home in Mexico City. James's book, World Revolution, had caught Trotsky's attention. At the time, it was one of the clearest takedowns of the Stalinist idea of socialism in one country in the English language. During his time in the United States, James would co-found the Johnson Forest Tendency, a Marxist organization dedicated to bringing Marxism to the contemporary world while aiming to critique the USSR as a state capitalist society instead of a fundamentally Marxist one. In 1953, he was forced to return to Britain amidst the peak of McCarthyist demagoguery. Several years after his return to Britain, James went back to his childhood home of Trinidad to assist in the fight for independence. From there, he continued his work in trying to dismantle the remnants of and damage done by European colonialism in Africa. During these years, he would work in several African nations and with many leaders in black Marxism, including developing a special relationship with historian, activist, and academic Walter Rodney. James would even give a talk about Rodney's death during the Guyana Revolution and its implications on a grander political scale. James spent his final years in Britain feeling compelled to stick around in the wake of the 19th.
Yes, my man Media. He lived in Mexico City. He was kind of a bit of a globetrotter.
Yeah, he really, you know, he really broke the ice over there in Mexico City.
Yes.
So I believe he had potential relations with one Frida Kahlo while he was there.
Allegedly, but allegedly. I've heard conflicting, you know, accounts.
Wait, what did I do?
What did we say? We're nothing but respectful. Okay.
The original pick me. That one's fucking great. Oh, jeez. God, you guys are too much, man. You guys are too much.
Yeah.
One Brixton riots, a racially charged clash between mostly black youth and mostly white police that arose due to discriminatory police policies and practices.
You may recall the Clash song, Guns of Brixton.
In 1989, the 88-year-old James died suddenly of a chest infection. CLR James presents a clear link to the trend of black academics and activists adopting and spreading Marxist and communist theory as revolutionaries. Inspired by collective action during times like the Haitian Revolution, James's lean into Marxism helped set the stage for many a black revolutionary in the decades following his famous lecture tour. Figures like Malcolm X, Angela Davis, Assata Shakur, and many more stood on his metaphorical shoulders as they carried radical black academia into the present day.
Right. So, chat, I'm glad that we were all very mature.
Philbo, he still seems really cool. He is really cool.
He is that's really cool.
You know what I mean? And, you know, people are going to have differing opinions about certain actually existing socialist projects. And I think we can, like, you know, and I think Larry was saying this before about Glenn Sean Coulthard.
Yeah.
You know, he said things he doesn't like about China. And it's not like you're like, well, this is useless. Let's throw all of this in the garbage. Where is that coming from?
It's the thing that Tay sent.
Why can I hear it now?
Oh, because it's playing on YouTube. So, you know, for those of you watching the VOD of this that I'll hopefully upload because I want to be, like, you know, more on top of this. By the way, we are starting up a new YouTube channel where you will be able to find all of our VODs and not just on our main page where the new interviews and podcast episodes will show.
Philbo, trot jokes are totally allowed. We are definitely not dismissing trot jokes in chat.
Yeah.
Please continue. Let the trot jokes flow. We're just saying let's not besmirch the name of the great C.L.R. James because he believes it's something that's a little bit different. That still has many of the like ideological tenets that we all strive for and can appreciate and respect. You know, let's just not besmirch the good man's name.
It's mellow enough, Tay, you know.
Yeah, I think it's fine. Okay, so I believe this one is me, right? Yes. Okay. So, as our ties were being developed and cemented, the first edition of How Europe Underdeveloped Africa was jointly published by Bongo Le Ouverture and the Tanzanian Publishing House in 1972. For all of those who could obtain copies of the work, it was like a mighty uplifting gust of fresh air. Without romanticizing pre-colonial Africa, Walter had placed it in the context of human development across the globe, traced its real historical relationship to the colonizing forces of Europe, and suggested the path for Africa's movement toward a new life for its people and a new role in reshaping of the world. The book immediately struck an exciting and responsive chord among many in this country. Among politically oriented black people, it played something of the same formative role as Frantz Fanon's Wretched of the Earth almost a decade before. Indeed, both men were dealing with the ravages of colonialism and neocolonialism. Both were calling for a break with the exploiting, ravaging system in order to move forward and create a new order. Both were living examples of the transformation they demanded. And so, now he's beginning to do his first writing, being compared to a certain type of the same formative role as Frantz Fanon, who we'll be learning about in just a moment, if you don't already know, which I'm sure you know some.
So this was an excellent attempt, Tay, but, you know, I do not want anybody to feel like I can't concentrate with two voices talking at the same time. So let's hope this works. And, Pat will no longer be able to hear it. So, again, just remind me the next time I'm over there, like, hey, log me into your thing.
All right.
Like Fanon's seminal work, Rodney's also began from an African-Caribbean perspective, but we in the United States of America immediately recognized the global connection. Although Walter ended his primary historical analysis with the close of the 1950s, he nevertheless offered a brief, cogent, and powerful treatment of the contemporary role of the United States in the exploitation of Africa. Implicitly warning us against our own active or passive participation in that damaging work. But there were also connections perhaps even more directly related to the Afro-American struggles in the early 1970s, especially in his treatment of colonial and neo-colonial education and its effects on the African mind and spirit. For instance, Walter wrote, "In the final analysis, perhaps the most important principle of colonial education was that of capitalist individualism in Africa. Both the formal school system and the informal value system of colonialism destroyed social solidarity and promoted the worst form of alienated individualism without social responsibility."
Very interesting. Rodney is just like unwaveringly Marxist in his view of things. You know what I mean? Like almost every word that comes out of his mouth is just dripping with like Marxist dialectical analysis. It's quite impressive.
Yeah, because he's talking about like individualist, like, you know, alienation. He's talking about like, you know, social responsibilities.
Now, you know who else was very impressive?
Frantz Fanon.
Frantz Fanon, yeah. So let's talk about Frantz Fanon for a moment.
No subtitles. Sorry. Get wrecked, chat.
There's no words. It's one of those short telesword videos. It's just like this.
Oh, shit.
He fought in World War II.
I did not know that.
All right, so we have one more video regarding Fanon coming up right now, and you can apply this to whatever, you know, whatever you feel comfortable applying it to.
Apply liberally.
On Violence is the first section of the 1961 book written by Frantz Fanon called The Wretched of the Earth. In this section, Fanon undertakes to analyze the specificities of violence within the context of decolonization. He tries to answer the following question: what are the negative and positive aspects of violence? Fanon himself was born and raised as a colonial subject under the rule of France in the archipelago of Antilles. His relationship with the powers of colonization is therefore acutely felt and extremely personal. Fanon describes decolonization as a historical process where two contradicting powers meet each other face to face, the colonizer and the colonized. The colonizer, for Fanon, is the one who brings violence in the home and into the mind of the native. In fact, Fanon thinks that violence is the defining characteristic or the natural state of the colonial rule. Such violence is not always physical. It often manifests itself as a form of cultural discrimination or outright dehumanization of the native subject. The very psyche of the colonized subject is successfully fabricated by the colonizer, who tries to shape an animal out of the colonized. Correspondingly, when the colonized subject is rendered non-human, colonizers are left, in their effort to control the non-human, with a single option: constant physical violence. For Fanon, therefore, the process of decolonization really is about the creation of new men. Through active participation in decolonization, native people can bring about a new generation of men with a new language and a new humanity. But how does violence fit into all of this? As we mentioned, violence is the natural state of the colonizer's rule. Therefore, in order to liberate themselves, native people have to find an outlet through which the forces accumulated in the forms of colonizer's aggression can be released. This is what Fanon calls the collective catharsis, which describes native people's experience of violently obliterating the colonial rule. By virtue of this decolonizing violence, the colonized subject can reclaim the new generation of men, a new language, and a new humanity. The humanity that once had been denied to the colonized subject can be regained, according to Fanon, by engaging in revolution. Fanon says, "Violence frees the native from his inferiority complex and from his despair and inaction. It makes him fearless and restores his self-respect. Most importantly, by engaging in liberation, the colonized subject discovers that his life, his breathing, and his heartbeats are the same as the colonists. The colonized subject discovers that the skin of a colonist is not worth more than the native's." Fanon clarifies, however, that violence can never be pursued without a clear political goal. Violence, which may bring about liberation, also leaves behind untreatable physical and mental problems. Revolutionary violence may in fact leave native people rootless and stateless. Fanon is determined to describe violence as equally harmful to both the colonizer and the colonized. For Fanon, there is no reason why the violence that destroyed the indigenous fabric should not result in vindication and appropriation of such violence when the colonized finally swarm into the forbidden cities.
Quite timely, Sincho.
I don't know what to say about that, you know. I think the video said enough, personally. Right. But, things to keep in mind.
So, you know, maybe at some point we can read Wretched of the Earth.
The only thing Wretched of the Earth is, again, like, very much talking about the black experience, right, and the colonized experience. And it's like, you know, I generally, when I like to I like to read about that from more of a historical view than more of like what it is to like evolve as like a black person under colonization, or evolve as a, you know, I don't know. It's just, it's a little, it's weird ground for me to tread on personally, but yeah.
Right. So we're moving on to the introduction, and let me just start this up and see where it takes us. With the help of many persons in the United States and other parts of the world, Walter found opportunities to lecture and teach in an attempt to keep in touch with his comrades outside of Guyana and to earn the funds his family needed. James Turner, director of the Africana Studies and Research Center at Cornell, and Emmanuel Wallerstein of the State University of New York at Birmingham were especially helpful to those of us who were trying to organize these activities. Whenever Walter traveled abroad, especially as the government's repression increased, many friends urged him to leave Guyana and bring himself and his family to some place of relative safety. Walter's response to us generally had two parts. First was his sense of the responsibility he had to his comrades and the people of Guyana. He said that he was working among them to encourage them in a fearless struggle for the transformation of themselves and their society, and that he could not leave simply because he happened to have ready access to the means of escape. Second, Rodney said he felt he had been singularly privileged in the broad set of contacts he had been able to establish in the course of his work and travels throughout the Third World. For him, this privilege carried with it a responsibility to continue to share with his people the content and spirit of that international network of women and men involved in liberation struggles. Thus, without any trace of a desire for martyrdom, but with a clear recognition of the situation he faced, Walter's response was always the same. It is imperative that I stay here.
So, this is what we must keep in mind about Rodney's life and his death, is that he did not have to be in the presence of the revolutionary upheaval. He did not have to be shoulder to shoulder with the people and the workers and in the direct danger of the colonial violence and the counter-revolutionary violence. He was making swanky connections in fucking London, you know, and probably could have just been in, like, you know, high-rise affluent parties and things like that with other academics and, you know, high-life individuals and things like that. If you read Paul Robeson's book, he talks about how he got into that and it kind of, like, hurt his spirit because, like, he moved out to London and actually did a lot of that, like, highfalutin, high society life, but always felt alienated from it because of the racial components. Right. But that's another story. I apologize. But he vowed to stay in Guyana, in Jamaica, fighting directly alongside these things for the things that he believed in. And it ultimately cost him his life. It ultimately caused his martyrdom. So, toward the end, all these dangers, hopes, and tensions were concentrated in the events of one last year-long outpouring of life and death. In June 1979, the WPA formally announced it had transformed itself into a political party, one that would work untiringly for the overthrow of the stronghold that Burnham's People's National Congress had established in the country. In the following month, a government building in Georgetown was set afire, and Walter and four other WPA members were among the eight persons arrested and charged with arson. Because it was a government building, the charge was very serious. But it was also clear that many observers that the action was entirely set up as part of the measures for breaking the force of Rodney's small but influential organization. On the day of the arraignment, Father Bernard Danke, a priest who was a reporter for the Catholic Standard, was fatally stabbed in the back as he stood observing a pro-WPA demonstration outside the court building. From that point on, a repressive situation deteriorated into what might be called a long night of official terrorism, including bombings, police beatings, and escalating threats of extermination by Burnham against Walter and other leaders of the opposition WPA. So, this is unfortunately the maelstrom that would cause Dr. Rodney to lose his life. unflinchingly remaining alongside the revolutionary process in Guyana. He felt that he was needed in Guyana, despite him having all these academic accolades and beginning to get renowned all around the world. Literally could have been anywhere in whatever kind of worldly comfort at that point, you know, especially comparative to that of Guyana,
right,
in that political strife. But he was there, he was going to jail, and then we'll read in the next slide what ultimately ends up happening.
And this is a guy that's only like 30 years old by the end of his life.
I don't know, man. I don't know if I'm built that strong to resist that kind of temptation, not to just like take my, especially if you have like kids and stuff, because I think he had kids too, right?
I would assume so. Yeah, that's, yeah. The book's dedicated to his kids. If you open it up, it's in the first page. It's, it says that one kid's name's Pat.
Look at that.
Look at that.
Chose a strong Irish name. By the end of February 1980, two of Walter's close associates in the WPA, Ohene Koama and Edward Dublin, there it is, had been killed by the police. Others shot and beaten. Still others jailed, their houses raided, ransacked, and bombed. By then, some of the leading members of the WPA were actually being held as political prisoners in Guyana, for their government refused them permission to leave the country. However, Rodney managed to get out in May 1980, accepting an invitation from the Patriotic Front to attend the independence ceremonies in Zimbabwe. Then Walter returned to Guyana, continuing to work in the archives to organize among the people. He had ominously told some of us in this country that we might not see him again. On June 2nd, the trial for arson began, witnessed by concerned observers from the Caribbean, the United States, and England. Within a few days, it was clear that the government had no case and could not prosecute Rodney and his co-workers. As a result, on June 6th, at the request of the government, the trial was adjourned until August 20th.
So, continuing from that, 1 week after that adjournment, on Friday evening, June 13th, Walter was sitting in his brother's car waiting for Donald Rodney at the driver's seat. They had stopped at the house of a man who we now know had infiltrated the ranks of the WPA. Donald Rodney went to pick up what the man said was a walkie-talkie that Walter wanted. As they stood in the infiltrator's yard around 7:30 p.m., he told Rodney to drive off and wait for a test signal at 8 p.m. Donald returned to the car and drove away. Then the signal came. It turned out to be the explosion that ended Walter Rodney's life. A few weeks before his death, Rodney had been persistently interviewed about the dangers that he faced and his plans for defending himself against them. He said, "As to my own safety and the safety of a number of other persons within the WPA, we will try to guarantee our safety by the level of political mobilization and political action inside and outside the country. Ultimately, it is this rather than any kind of physical defense which will guarantee our safety. None of us are unmindful of the threat that is constantly posed. We don't regard ourselves as adventurers, as martyrs, or potential martyrs, but we think there is a job which needs to be done, and at a certain point in time, we have to do what has to be done."
Yeah, so this is a guy that did not want to be a martyr, did not think of himself as a martyr.
It is now, I think, widely known inside the country and outside of the country that first of all, the Americans intervened along with the British to abort the democratic process from 1953 onwards. And secondly, that once the present government got into power, it extended the scale of electoral fraud so that we cannot claim at the present time to be a politically enfranchised people. There's the whole area of the media, the newspapers and the radio. We find that since the government has taken over the paper, it has ostensibly nationalized these newspapers, meaning in the interest of the nation, but in practice it is specifically in the interest of the ruling party.
Very sad.
Very.
Very sad stuff there.
I think this one's me, right?
Yep.
Again, Walter's courageous sense of commitment and integrity evokes sharp memories of Fanon. He too sacrificed his life for the liberation of his people and died before he was 40. He too called the children of Africa and all those damned by Europe to seize the initiative and change our ways. He too asked us to resist all temptations to live out our lives as permanent victims, angry accusers, or fawning imitators of Europe. It was he who said, "Come then, comrades. The European game has finally ended. Look at them today, swaying between atomic and spiritual disintegration. We must find something different. We today can do everything so long as we do not imitate Europe. So long as we are not obsessed by the desire to catch up with Europe. We have taken the liberty at this point of changing Europe to Europe America. We think Fanon would permit that. The Third World faces Europe and America like a colossal mass whose aim should be to try to resolve the problems to which Europe and America has not been able to find the answers. So comrades, let it not pay tribute to Europe and America by creating states, institutions, and societies which draw their inspiration from her. If we want humanity to advance a step further, if we want to bring it up to a different level than that which Europe and America has shown it, then we must invent and we must make discoveries. If we wish to live up to our people's expectations, we must seek the response elsewhere than in Europe and America. For Europe and America, for ourselves, and for humanity, comrades, we must turn over a new leaf. We must work out new concepts, and we must try to set afoot a new man." Richard of the Earth, 252-255.
Jig is up, Europe.
I mean, like, you know, Tinchal, if anything, just borrowing from, the work of Gerald Horn, America is just an extension of Europe.
So, from Walter's perspective, that was the job that needs to be done. The challenge that he and his comrades had determined to take on, experimenting, inventing, risking, trying to work out new forms of organization, new modus of struggle, new visions and concepts to guide and undergird them. Starting on their own home ground. For Walter Rodney, the WPA was one element of the job, and his research and writing was another. He saw no contradiction between them. All elements of the task were held firmly together by the righteous integrity of his life. The disciplined power of his visions and his undying love for the people and their possibilities. Thus, he went about doing the job that needed to be done. But, as it was said of Malcolm X, so it could be said of Walter, he became much more than there was time for him to be. Now we are starkly aware of the fact that the time he no longer has is really ours. That the job he took on is in our hands to continue to redefine wherever we are, whoever we are. The call that he tried to answer is here for us all. If we want humanity to advance a step further, we must invent and we must make discoveries. We must turn over a new leaf. We must work out new concepts and we must try to set afoot a new humanity. 255, Rush of the Earth. Very powerful stuff. This is Walter Rodney's wife speaking on the anniversary of his death, just for a quick 5 minutes. Greetings and solidarity from the Rodney family.
Good morning, good evening to all the participants. I would like to express my appreciation to Visu Malangu of the Walter Rodney's People Revolutionary Library, which was inspired by Rodney's ideas and activism, for the invitation to bring greetings from the Rodney family and the Walter Rodney Foundation on the occasion of your teaching entitled Walter Rodney and Anti-Imperialist Politics Today, to honor the legacy of Walter Rodney, which is being held in partnership with Forge, a Pan-African progressive left organization, during June 13th and the 16th, 2022. Walter Rodney was assassinated on June 13, 1980, at 8 p.m. by the Fort Burnham PNC state apparatus. Walter Rodney was 38 years old, a husband and father of three young children. Today, 42 years later, the Rodney family continues to seek justice for Walter and his brother Donald, who were in the car with him when he was blown up by an anti-personnel bomb placed into a walkie-talkie by his assassin, Gregory Smith, who is an agent of the government. In 2014, a presidential commission of inquiry was commissioned by President Donald Ramatar to investigate the killing of Rodney over a two-year process. The work of the commission was aborted when the APNU government came into power in 2016. However, the commissioners were able to produce a comprehensive report eliminating the involvement of the PNC government and state agencies' involvement in the planned and orchestrated assassination of Walter Rodney. Some recent developments include: on June the 10th, 2021, the Attorney General and Minister of Legal Affairs, Anil Nandal, of the current Guyanese government, led by President Ashraf Ali, admitted that it was a state-organized killing and declared to the National Assembly that the government is committed to right this tragic wrong. On June the 4th, 2022, Walter Rodney's tomb and memorial were declared by the National Trust and National Monuments. I'm excited to endorse the event, which continues Rodney's legacy, but I would urge the youth and organizations involved that the best way to honor Rodney is by sharing his strategy of groundings for self-emancipation, human right, and justice for people of African descent, working people, and the marginalized globally. In using Rodney's framework, you must apply them to your unique circumstances, community, and national needs. We should not only honor him on his birthday, March 23, 1942, or his assassination, June 13, 1980, but daily as we continue our work through public organizing and activism.
Look, I wasn't going to point it out, all right? But there's only so many, like, you know, bookshelves that I can see, like, you know, Julius and Yarere, fucking France Fanon.
Yeah,
Fanon, right? Langston Hughes.
Yeah, black skin, white mask is right up there in the top left corner.
Right, and then Kamala Harris, and just be like, I have to just ignore it. I just have to pretend it's not there.
I'm telling you, when I was in India, when I was in Kerala, in Kannur, for the Party Congress, they did a pop-up book fair. It's where I bought my Vijay Prashad book about the excerpts of Lenin and the Vijay Prashad excerpts of Ho Chi Minh, which had just come out at the time. I bought both of those there. I also bought my girlfriend a Kollontai book. But right next to the Grover Fur that they had there was the Obama biography.
The what?
Which part do you need?
The what biography?
Obama.
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 Global.
Right next to the Grover Fur. Damn. I should have took a picture.
That's crazy. An Obama biography right next to a Grover Fur book?
Yeah.
Okay, I just needed to see if, like, the Global Lockdown book was what I thought it was. It is not. Anyways, I'm going to continue this video, and we're not going to mock or make fun of the widow of Walter Rodney, which is not what we're doing. I am not. I was going to ignore it. You're the one that pointed out to Kamala Harris.
I did.
I would like to use one of Rodney's quotes, which I think is pertinent to your teaching over the next 3 days. And I quote, "Political instability is manifesting itself in Africa as a chronic symptom of the underdevelopment of the political life within the imperialist context. Military coups have followed one after the other, usually meaning nothing to the mass of the people, and sometimes representing a reactionary reversal of the efforts at national liberation. This trend was well exemplified in Latin American history, so that its appearance in neo-colonial South Vietnam or in neo-colonial Africa is not at all surprising. If economic power is centered outside national African boundaries, then political and military power in any real sense is also centered outside until and unless the masses of peasants and workers are mobilized off an alternative to the system of sham political independence. How Europe Underdeveloped, 1972. I wish you a successful teaching and look forward to our continued collaboration. Hungera, Uku Halali Sela. Thank you. How did that
sound? And then they close the door. All right. Sometimes you just forget what you're doing or how to do it in the middle of doing it.
Where am I?
Yeah. That's what's happening to me right now. All right. Hey, Red Wizard. We just started. Well, not really just started, but like 3.5 hours ago, we started Walter Rodney's How Europe Underdeveloped Africa.
Is this one me or you?
I don't remember. I'll just say it's
yeah.
Me?
Yep.
Okay. It is in our courageous, creative attempts to respond to such a magnificent summons that we begin to break the chains of our underdevelopment and shake the foundations of all human exploitation. And it is not clear by now that the process of exploitation leads to an underdeveloped humanity, both at the center and at the periphery. Do we not see the underdevelopment of the center in the homeland of the exploiters is simply covered over with material possessions and deadly weaponry, but that the nakedness and human retardation are nevertheless there? So who among us does not need to break the coils of the past to transcend and recreate our history? Perhaps it is only as we take up the challenge of Walter and Fanon that we will be prepared to give up all the deadly games of the last half millennia, seeking out new means of defense, new forms of struggle, new pathways toward revolution, new visions of what truly humane society demands of us. Only as we begin to entertain such thoughts, consider such inventions, will we be prepared to carefully examine again and then move beyond the marvelous limits of how Europe underdeveloped Africa, pressing on in the spirit of Rodney and Fanon to ask a new question. How shall we redevelop the world? You know, I have a feeling Pat's doing this to me on purpose. Or, you know, it's not Pat. It's Angela Davis that's doing this to me on purpose.
We haven't been reading Angela Davis in a while.
This isn't still Angela Davis?
That was only like the first four slides. All right. That was only the foreword, and then we did the preface, and now we're in the intro.
All right, so whoever wrote the intro, right, is doing this to me on purpose, right? They know I'm on the spectrum. They're doing it to me on purpose, all right?
You have to say it. I can't say it.
Yeah. I did everything right, and still...
I did everything right.
I did everything right, and I'm still being canceled for reading quotes out of a book.
Blaming a black woman for
I thought I was still reading Angela Davis. All right.
No, Angela Davis did the first the foreword, and then we just saw his widow.
And they indicted me.
All right. So, beginning with ourselves, beginning where we are. What must we tear down? What must we build up? What foundations must we lay? Who shall we work with? What visions can we create? What hope shall possess us? How shall we organize? How shall we be related to those who raise the same questions in South Africa and El Salvador and Guyana? How shall we communicate with others the urgency of our time? How shall we envision and work for the revolutionary transformation of our own country? What are the inventions, the discoveries, the new concepts that will help us move toward the revolution we need in this land? Neither rhetoric nor coercion will serve us now. We must decide where we shall remain crippled and underdeveloped, or move to participate in our own healing by taking on the challenge to redevelop ourselves, our people, our endangered nation, and the earth. No one can force us toward this. By conventional measurements, there are no guarantees of success, as the blood of our martyrs and heroes, known and less known, like Walter Rodney and Frantz Fanon, Ruby Doris and Fannie Lou, Malcolm and Martin, fully testify. But there is a world waiting for us. Indeed, many worlds await us. One is the world of our children, not yet born or just beginning, but wanting to live, to grow, to become their best possible selves. This will not happen unless, as Walter suggests, the center is transformed and fundamentally changed. That will not happen unless we are transformed, redeveloped, and renewed. The future of our children depends on these rigorous transformations.
Being canceled in chat right now.
I know, it's, you know, it was inevitable. It was inevitable.
I can't tell if they're saying, if I'm supposed to read that as Joe Ever or however or
is it whoever, mate?
Jover? Is it Jover? Hover? Jover? Okay. Dude, I don't know.
Here's an interesting video. It's like it takes this novel, The Deep, and puts it, like, there isn't that many, like, kind of like The Deep history, Walter Rodney and the Underdevelopment of Africa. I thought it was pretty interesting. I don't know. You could all tell me what you think.
Don't come on me, Sinjal. Okay.
Don't come on.
Don't come on me. All right.
Pat and Johnny for Joe Ever.
In order to understand where we are and how we got here, we need to grapple with history. As I submerge myself in the molecules of the past, attempting to diagnose the condition of this system, I found it difficult to pin down what has actually happened. I reflected on how history was taught to me in school and I realized that it was severely lacking in substance. It was like standing in the shallow end of a swimming pool and being told that I was in the Atlantic Ocean. There were special occasions where we'd remember anniversaries, but it seemed like we only touched upon a few major events which centered around a handful of people. When we learned about Black History Month, it didn't really extend beyond Martin Luther King's I Have a Dream speech or the fact that Rosa Parks sat on the back of a bus peacefully. And the little that we did learn about the transatlantic slave trade, we weren't told why it happened and certainly not the role of the United Kingdom. Today, the world seems to be in complete disarray. And in my journey to get to the bottom of this vast ocean of history, I found myself descending to levels that the sun's light can't even reach. It certainly hasn't been smooth sailing, as much of Africa's recent history is soaked in a lot of pain. Wading through it all has been rather challenging. A novel that illustrates this particularly well is called The Deep by River Solomon, which is about an underwater civilization of mermaids who are descendants of pregnant enslaved Africans that were seen as too much of an inconvenience to be kept aboard slave ships. The Deep takes this tragic historical fact and imagines an alternate reality where Africans were transformed into mermaids and developed a utopia away from the dystopia that Africans above the waters were subjected to. Instead of imploding under the pressure of the deep ocean, the Wajiru people thrived. Their culture exists in an almost permanent state of mindfulness, encouraging their people to be as present as possible and not dwelling too much on the past. Every year, however, they have a remembering ceremony where the historian, keeper of all memories, shares everything with them before taking the memories back for another year. This is seen by most to be a good compromise. They're able to hang on to their history while avoiding the long-term pain of remembering. The trade-off, however, is that the historian has to carry that burden alone for the rest of the year. They have to endure the suffering for the sake of their people. The novel is centered around the historian Yetu, who's finding it increasingly hard to deal with the daily anguish of the past. The disassociation with the present makes it hard to stay tethered to reality. One day, Yetu makes a choice that may fundamentally disrupt the peace that the Wajiru people had known for centuries. And the consequences of holding on to unresolved traumas may or may not lead to an unbridled tsunami of rage. The Deep shows the importance of fiction and how it can be used to reimagine history without rewriting it. The novel was inspired by a song of the same name, written by David Diggs, a member of a band called The Clippings, and they were inspired by Drexia, an American electronic music duo from Detroit, Michigan. It's like a game of artistic telephone, an open source approach where the slight adjustments in the retellings are a feature, not a bug. The Deep is a work of fiction, which is where these kinds of utopian fantasies work well. But when it comes to analyzing...
It's not The Clippings. It's Clipping.
Is that what it is? I don't know.
Yeah. No, they're like extremely popular. You should check them out if you never have.
In our reality, I'd argue that a more scientific approach is preferred. History is not as objective as it seems. The prevailing narrative is usually written by the victors to make themselves look as noble as possible. For instance, the United States celebrates Christopher Columbus Day every year and his voyages into the so-called New World, but the mainstream media barely mentions his atrocities against indigenous people or his role in the slave trade. Our view of the past is also limited by our technological and scientific capacity. For instance, when the theory of evolution was discovered, it reshaped the history of humanity and life in general. It was revealed that the evolution of life is a process, and the assumption that Homo sapiens were static beings entirely separate from the other organisms on this planet was no longer valid from a scientific perspective. A common view of the development of human society is that societal paradigms don't really shift until a five-headed genius who's ahead of their time comes along with a new idea and changes everything. For instance, people like Tesla, Galileo, and Da Vinci are all placed into this category. And although they made some important contributions, this view often downplays the contributions of humanity as a whole and the cumulative intelligence that went into a particular breakthrough. I think a more interesting view of history should factor in the society as a whole. If we were to look at the major historical changes, it seems to be tied to what we are able to produce, the mode of production, and the people's relationship to those things. When humans entered the agricultural revolution, surpluses were created for the first time, and that allowed for certain humans to specialize in particular fields, meaning there was a greater division of labor than before. Some people had different relations to the mode of production than others, and consequently led some to have more power than others. This also applies to feudal relations between lords and serfs, as well as our current epoch, that of the employee and the boss. In order to transition from one epoch to another, it requires a certain level of development, and over time those quantitative incremental developments lead to major qualitative paradigm shifts. This also applies to the natural world as well. Heat up a cup of water, 1 degree at a time, and not much changes except for a gradual rise in temperature. But once you hit 100 degrees, all of a sudden that liquid boils and evaporates. Similarly, in human society,
is it 100
certain
degrees?
Discoveries will not have.
Oh, is it? In the other way of doing things, right?
Yeah, I guess, yeah.
In Celsius, isn't zero freezing and 100 boiling?
I think so. I don't know. I don't really
know.
That's
a way smarter way of doing it. That's the way smarter way than doing it. I don't know what the fuck we're doing over here with Fahrenheit, like a bunch of idiots.
I just know that, like, 60's kind of cool, 50's kind of cool, 70's pretty nice, 80's a little warmer, 90's too hot.
In real measurements, yes, that's what it is. Yeah. It makes so much sense to do that. Instead of like arbitrarily being like, well, 32 is actually freezing, just so you know. And I'm pretty sure my kettle boils at about 212 degrees.
I don't know. I don't know those numbers.
And I also don't use a kettle.
No, neither do I.
I do use a kettle. I was pretending to be you.
No, I literally don't have a kettle. I literally boil a pot of water.
Yeah, and 212 is boiling, yeah. So, and why, see, we're using the imperial one. I use a kettle because I have an espresso machine, and when I make my Americano, I don't want it to get too cold from the tap water. The tap water, when I fill out my espresso, if I just use the hot tap water, it gets too cold too quick. So I have to use the hot water from the kettle.
Zero is 32 Celsius to Fahrenheit. What?
Oh my God.
Been made if it weren't for the prerequisite tools, technologies, and insights that already existed from centuries of tinkering around to make things more refined or efficient. Failing to acknowledge this may lead people to believe that the problems that we face today will be solved by the sole ingenuity of the startup entrepreneurs in Silicon Valley as opposed to the thousands of employees that do most of the developing, and all the Africans and people in the global south who mine the resources under inhumane conditions to power this globalized system. Some people, to their credit, may acknowledge that this system was built on the backs of enslaved Africans, which is true, but not much is spoken of the impacts that it had on the African continent as a whole. Walter Rodney contributed a great deal in this regard with his 1972 book, How Europe Underdeveloped Africa. He acknowledged that, like many other places on Earth, Africans were developing before the arrival of Europeans. According to Rodney, a society develops economically as its members increase jointly their capacity for dealing with their environment. This capacity for dealing with the environment is dependent on the extent to which they understand the laws of nature, science, on the extent to which they put that understanding into practice by devising tools, technology, and on the manner in which work is organized. Some places in Africa were living under primarily communal relations, which meant that the land belonged to the people living on it. For example, a family, or on a slightly larger scale, a clan of people coming together to accommodate each other for various reasons. Things weren't all sunshine and rainbows, but it must be noted that cooperation was usually preferred over competition. On the other hand, there were places that resembled the feudal relations of Europe and Asia, where the mode of production had developed further, such that it required a greater division of labor and specialization. In other words, African cultures did experience a degree of uneven development across the continent, just like other places in the world. The key thing to recognize is that prior to the transatlantic slave trade, the gap between Africa and Europe wasn't as clear-cut as it is now. Furthermore, when Europeans did arrive, they were pretty impressed by the masonry, metallurgy, quality of fabrics, architecture, and more. And in some cases, they preferred the craftsmanship of Africans than their own goods. It follows that a certain amount of development had to have been present in order to be in a position to specialize to that degree. Africa's development was interrupted, leading to a stagnation of economic development. As Rodney states, the underdevelopment is a product of imperialist and colonialist exploitation. African and Asian societies were developing independently until they were taken over. When that happened, exploitation increased and the export of surplus ensued, depriving the societies of the benefit of their natural resources and labor. This is an integral part of underdevelopment in the contemporary sense. It could also be argued that African development actually regressed, because the knowledge that was acquired, whether it's scientific, mathematical, philosophical, musical, religious, or otherwise, was simply forgotten in many cases, erased like footprints on the beach, and replaced by the economic incentives of Europe and America. Just imagine if you were forbidden from practicing a certain skill. After a certain amount of time, that knowledge will fade, and it won't be passed on to the next generation. For centuries, Africans could not reap the rewards of their own labor. They could not develop those incremental changes that would have led to the paradigm shifts that I mentioned earlier. Those leaps were had in the West, where they didn't have to bother as much with hands-on agriculture and instead spent most of the time developing their industries. Even James Watt expressed his gratitude to slave owners who essentially financed his steam engine. In other words, the capital required to develop the West is entangled with the super exploitation and underdevelopment of the global South. And after the colonial era ended, the gap had widened so much so that it would seem to the untrained eye that Africans were backward people who hadn't contributed anything of merit to history. The most pernicious reason for this is that it's some kind of genetic inferiority, the same reasoning that was used to justify the exploitation in the first place. In 2020, this hasn't changed all that much. Africans are still subjected to systemic racism, and in the global South, Africans are still being subjected to the same super exploitation that has been going on for centuries. Justification often given is that Africans have to deal with these conditions until they become as productive as Western nations. But if that were true, Africa would have developed by now, considering the inconceivable amount of labor that has been expelled over the centuries. In addition to this, Africans at home and abroad are often used as shock absorbers for the inherent instability of the system. And even in cases where the Western working class had struggled for better conditions, Rodney claims that the global South often had to carry that burden to ensure that profits could still be made. And at the same time, those concessions tended to pacify those working class people so that they'd stop challenging the underlying contradictions of the system. This is an uncomfortable truth to come to terms with, but I think it's worth considering in trying to fully understand the scale of the problem we face. We live under a global system, and in order to deal with the global problems that we face, global solutions are required. Unless we understand the inner workings of the system and how interconnected the different sectors of the economy really are, everything we do will be at best band-aid solutions and at worst a deepening wound that will cause more complications down the line. Utopian fantasies are fine. The Deep was a very enjoyable novel and provided the temporary escape that I needed while studying the atrocities that black and indigenous people had to deal with. However, I also recognize that I have to come back to our present historical moment to be grounded within these material conditions in order to formulate a scientific pathway to a fully automated post-scarcity sustainable planet. We can't just wait for the elites to have a change of heart, finally addressing the increasing wealth inequality or climate change or even systemic racism. They simply will not budge until the global masses decide that enough is enough. So don't shy away from history. Learn from it. There are valuable lessons to be learned from past successes and failures. And remember, we don't stand on the shoulders of giants. We stand on the shoulders of Gundams that have been operated by billions of people throughout history. Thanks as always for sticking around until the end of the video. As of recording this, we have breached 4,000 subscribers, which is something that I still have a hard time comprehending. So yeah, I appreciate everyone who has commented or liked or...
Yeah, no, I'm gonna subscribe to this channel because it sounds really good.
That book sounds interesting too, right?
Yeah. As far as like a fantasy book, yeah, that's a really cool concept.
All right, so we are rounding the end here, folks. Cool, awesome, glad everybody liked it. So this one's you.
Okay. Then there is another more difficult world that awaits us. The world of the sons and daughters, you know, and thembies of Europe and America who have begun to discover their own underdevelopment, who recognize the warping and desensitizing of their spirits. Without rehearsing all the old political arguments about coalitions and alliances, neither forgetting the past nor being bound by it, we must find some way to respond to them and to allow them to come in touch with us. There is no passing luxury in the old nice relations style. Rather, we now realize that the children of the oppressed and the children of the oppressors are involved in a dialectical relationship that is deeper than most of us choose to recognize, and that there is no fundamental redevelopment for one without the other. This is a heavy burden, but it represents a great possibility as well. In this country, with our peculiar history, it is also an undeniable reality. So it is, by the way of these difficult issues, that we return to Walter and his great work. Now, what seems demanded of us as we revisit how Europe underdeveloped Africa is that we read it this time in the light of Walter Rodney's life and death. This time in the consciousness of the dangerous, explosive American center. This time in the company of our children. This time in the presence of Fanon's insistent call to us all.
Good, good, good. All right, just a little bit more here. So, then we shall likely see more likely than ever before that Europe's underdevelopment of Africa and other worlds required Europe's ravaging of itself and everyone and everything that came under its sway. So the wounded are all around us and within us. Now opening ourselves to all those who recognize the brutal dialectics of underdevelopment, who acknowledge the cohesive powers of our common needs, our common dangers, and our common possibilities, we can begin to stand in a newly grounded solidarity and reach out toward each other, facing the harsh but beautiful fact that we must either redevelop ourselves and our world, or be pushed together into some terrible, explosive closing of the light. Of course, if we choose to go the way of our essential community, we cannot go far by responding primarily to the urgency of fear, for that would repeat history rather than transform it. And that would be unfaithful to a courageous brother like Walter. Instead, We must be drawn by the fact that there was much to attract us. For instance, one of the hopeful elements on the other side of the patterns of domination slash subordination of the past 500 years has been the drawing of humankind into networks of communication and interrelatedness that hold great possibilities for the establishment of new communities beyond the traditional national barriers. Reshaped and redirected, the mechanisms of exploitation may actually play some vital means of redevelopment within our grasp.
Hey, Lawsu. How you doing? Sorry, you're coming right at the end of us finishing the introduction, preface, and foreword of How Europe Underdeveloped Africa by Walter Rodney. So hopefully we get to, you know, see this, what is it, Sunday, as we cover the first chapter of How Europe Underdeveloped Africa by Walter Rodney. So one final slide. Now it is in our hands to overcome our history, to break the shackles of the past, and to redevelop ourselves, our people, our nation, and our world. To find humane, creative, and fearless ways of dealing with those who presently oppose such development. These are audacious visions and truly awesome responsibilities, but we must go forward. Indeed, it seems clear to us that even without any guarantees of success, we must move in the flow of humankind's best, most creative imagination, in this direction of our most profoundly renewing dreams. Anything less is inadequate for the perilous times. Anything less would be unworthy of the memory of our brother, the needs of our children, or the magnificent, untapped capacities of our own best selves. March 1981, Vincent Harding, Robert Hill, and William Strickland.
That, folks, is the introduction and just a little tiny glimpse into the life and times of Sir Walter Rodney. No, I'm not just kidding.
No, it's not Sir. It's Doctor.
No, but you know, it was it Sir Walter Raleigh?
Oh, yeah, Sir Walter Raleigh. Raleigh.
So, into the life and times of Dr. Walter Rodney, who we will be on a little journey with over the next month or so while we read through this book. And honestly, I'm more excited than ever right now after just reading through that and just learning. You know, Rodney certainly is a captivating figure, and I think his name gets thrown around a lot, but and gets a lot of lip service. But I think that, you know, when you actually start engaging with him, it's that much more palpable. There it is, palpable.
Right. Well, I think like that's the one thing that like this with this platform, what we hope to do in covering the books that we do is that like it's one thing to see like a snippet, a quotation. It's one thing to hear a speech. It's one thing to hear someone else quoting these authors, these thinkers, these revolutionary figures, right, that we, you know, hold very near and dear. But it's another thing to engage with their work, right, to read it in full or as full like as we can do on this platform without like literally just dryly reading the PDF to you. But you know, I hope that you take advantage of the fact that now the PDF can be found for this book you know, in our old Discord, right?
I was just reading what Sam said. We should definitely play the video that they sent. They marked the minute and everything. And
okay, yeah.
We can definitely do that.
So let me just pull out my phone. See if I can find it. Give me one second. And they said they put it in the Discord, right? Right?
Yeah.
Okay, hang on one second. Okay. No, that's not it. All right. Is this the right one? 122. What the fuck? Sorry. I'm sorry, everybody. Just give me one more second. Alright, I'm just gonna have to do it like this. So you just enjoy that for right now. Hope you're enjoying this nice, relaxing Caribbean jazz music.
In.
Do. And nope, that. And there we go. Okay, all right. So let me just pause this real quick. And play.
The development model of nationalism, which is that of the modern political and social organization of society. Chair, I think I've been long enough, and I'm going to end by returning you to Fanon. And Fanon, in The Wretched of the Earth, 1963, had actually recognized all what I'm trying to say. In 1963, when most nationalist movements had supplanted colonialists in power, one get a sense that Fanon had already known, as we said, what was going to happen. And this is what Fanon said in 1963, and we missed it, and hence we ended up in this moment of failure. And I quote, "Come, comrades, the European game is finally over. We must look for something else. We must learn, we can do anything today, provided we do not ape Europe. Provided we are not obsessed with catching up with Europe. Let us decide not to imitate Europe, and let us tense our muscles and our brains in a new direction. Come, brothers." Of course, Fanon should have added, "Come, sisters, we have far too much work on our hands to revel in outmoded games. Europe has done what it had to do. So, comrades, let us not pay tribute to Europe by creating states, by creating institutions and societies that draw their inspiration from it. Humanity expects other things from us than this grotesque and generally obscene emulation. If we want to transform Africa into a new Europe, then let us entrust the destinies of our countries to the Europeans. They will do a better job than the best of us. If we want to respond to the expectations of our people, we must look elsewhere besides Europe." End of quote. Thank you very much.
You guys, that was Dr. Luwazi Lushaba. I really hope that at some point we can get around to reading some of his work. But I know that Comrade Plants Fanon has definitely espoused their work as extremely poignant and important. And you should read on your own time if you haven't.
And then also, I thought it was funny that we're doing all this here. We're talking about Fanon. We're talking about, you know, I'm sorry, what does this person's name? I know that
Dr. Luwazi Lushaba.
Lushaba. And Plants isn't here tonight.
I know. Well, that wasn't he here earlier?
I don't think I saw him today.
Well, you know,
Just can we bring up the Patreon one more time? Because there has been some movement on it. I just want everybody to see. I want to give everybody play by play so they know what they're missing here. If they don't, it's changed by then.
Oh, okay. I need to refresh it then. Yeah. Sorry, I didn't realize.
So, guys, we have gotten the first vote has been cast for liberalism, a counter history.
Yay.
So now we have a tie game. We have a tie game between the brothers and the CIA's organized crime, which are the two recommendations from Plans Fanon and Strinsam. And then we also have a tie between the two streamer recommendations between Domenico Lucerto's liberalism and Mike Davis's late Victorian Holocausts. Now, this, you know, who knows where this will go over the next couple weeks. I don't know how you feel about books or these projects, or maybe you have one of these that you like, but your contribution could be the single push that could change the direction of this stream for a month. So if anybody would like to get on there, be a part of this process, help us sculpt Subversive History's trajectory, please jump in.
Yes. And, pay I'm for sure, your democracy.
Yes. Thank you for purchasing the democracy. Yes.
Look, all I'm trying to say is that if you want to influence where this stream goes for at least a month, right? The option is there for you if you can afford it. And I believe there's no minimum, right? Other than like a dollar.
I would hope the minimum is a dollar. I don't think I would entertain anybody that was like, here's one penny, I'm going to vote.
Right, here's 50 cents.
I don't think I would entertain that.
Read the book, dummies.
If you want to buy democracy, you need a dollar.
Right? So, you know, I might switch my vote for CIA organized crime for a fee.
Chop that up in the that's between you and chat.
Yeah,
that's between you and chat. That's just how democracy works, Wilco. You make side deals.
I feel like, is chat literally trying to have a runoff? Like, are they literally paying to do what they do for free all the time? Are you that dedicated to this? Wilco, are you fucking kidding me right now?
Robbo says CIA is organized crime is a legit book. I don't know. Somebody might need to contribute to that. I don't know. See how legit it is.
I swear to God, if you guys are literally paying to make sure that all the books are equal, right? Like, I hate you.
At least they're paying at this point. If they do that, we'll just pick a book.
All right, fine.
We'll just supersede the democratic structure and do what we want anyway.
Who would recently sub to the Patreon just to do that? I don't know, Wilco. Who might do that?
And not even just subscribe, but subscribe at the higher tier also. Like, give generously just to sabotage.
Chat should get a vote too. Chat is just as much a person as we all.
Is it fucked up to say that chat is 3/5 of a vote? Oh my God. Is that fucked up? I guess so. I'm sorry.
We need to rate out.
In the equation, I'd say in the equation, like between a Patreon and between like a Patreon member and a chatter and an unpaid chatter, that's about 3/5, right?
Red Wizard is like, I'll allow
it. Your day is awful. I'm sorry. Sorry, I get a little carried away sometimes. Yeah, I'm getting canceled in solidarity. In solidarity with Johnny for his repeated use of the R slur.
I didn't even say it. I'm reading a book.
That's not what I heard.
Yes, it is.
I feel like you kind of sprinkled that in there for your own to spice it up. You thought you were spicing it up.
No, I did not.
Johnny, I have to focus on your past issues because I just got flamed a little hard right there. And I need to point the fingers back at you. I need to remind them of your racism.
Is that even racism? I thought it would be like ableism, if anything. But I'm not even trying to do that.
Man, you're real defensive right now, dude.
I'm not, though.
Oh yeah, that's where the polls are. So we're gonna keep you updated day to day, stream by stream, just to see how everything progresses here in the most. Oh, Vlad the Victor, dude, 11 months. Look at Vlad at 11 months.
Damn.
Literally been here like from day one. I probably rivaling only Sam. Sam only rivaled by Sam in terms of length and girth with this community. Oh geez. Thank you, Erico. Put it in the folder. Put it in the dossier. Add to the file. And hey, you know, we were trying to get 33 subs for years of my birthday. We got 28, but honestly, I really identify as more of a 28-year-old. I live my life in a more 28-year-old fashion than I do 33-year-old. First spot going into Discord. Fuck. Yeah.
That's gonna look real good.
Do you think Marcus would think it was funny?
I can't speak for Marcus. Come on.
Don't you mean the 5 Ds while dodging the balls? Done. Damn it. All right.
You'll be subbed a year in just 9 days. Oh my God. Is it really that soon?
Wait, does that mean that we started in October?
No way.
I thought we started in November.
I thought we started in November too.
Can someone make sense of this?
No way. There's no way we started in October.
Nine days. What the fuck? Don't we have like something like here? Hold on, let me pull up our YouTube. Pull up our YouTube on the stream. I want to see something.
Subversive History.
Go to our oldest video upload.
Without further ado, let me introduce Michael Prenti.
November 5th, 2022.
Originally streamed November 5th, 2022. Okay. God, you guys almost gave me a heart attack, Sam.
Yeah, we have things planned.
No, wait, so now we actually know. What is it, November 5th?
Yeah.
Can we just watch a second of this? Can you just go into like the middle of it? I just want to hear what we're saying. I want to hear how stupid I sound on the first time I tried to stream.
Oh, God, you're going to make me fucking find it in the sea of tabs now?
Dude, I'm looking at... Oh.
There it is. Okay.
I found the media consistently portrayed the country in the worst light possible, presenting minority opinions of highly contested issues as facts, while rarely, if ever, acknowledging there was an opposing side. Furthermore, the majority of the empirical evidence often backed up the opposing side's viewpoints, that is, the more pro-Maduro view side. Furthermore, the majority of the media is passing off opposition propaganda as accurate, unbiased reporting. I uncovered a huge network of disinformation agents within the media, some of whom are directly paid by the U.S. in Venezuela. This is that book about Venezuela, because we were talking about inventing reality. Obviously, we're implying a degree of reality that is... We were so young, Johnny.
We were.
But at that point, the Greek communists were like, we don't want the monarchy back. They can stay in Egypt. They don't need...
I don't think I've spoken
exclusively
once.
Reactionary. I mean...
Oh, no. I was about to say something there.
I believe it's happening. But like, it's so funny how they shifted that window every little bit, like from like a completely like...
Is there anyone
topic, such as Iraq,
like,
is there anyone like, is there anyone watching?
Well, that's the thing, is that we don't have that ability to show chat yet.
StreamYards, though. Oh, it didn't pop up in StreamYards.
No, it didn't. That's why we changed, so that, like, you know, chat can finally be immortalized. And
thank you, Matt Nargon. Appreciate you.
Their little musings, you know, are in there for us to actually respond to, instead of me just
so
staring.
Well, I would say that
people are
Open Veins and Empire's Workshop are like two of like the most relevant text that you could read on the history of there was somebody I was talking to in the chat, politics and geopolitics in that region.
Vika, your dumb little painting is still
just kept driving for miles.
look at this firework.
I
know.
The fuck is it? Man, I thought like COVID like fireworks were, you know, wild. This is like something else.
What is this?
Do you remember that during COVID? My audio is just horrendous.
Also, yeah. Maybe we should save this for our year anniversary. Maybe we shouldn't blow our load here.
You're right. So what do you think? We're going to raid Seb's Dev?
Yeah. If it's between Seb's and 27, I mean, all love to 27, but, you know, Seb's more, way more, you know, intimately, you know, here with our channel than 27. Wouldn't you agree?
Yeah. 100%.
Well, this is what they want to do. They want to tie up the rankings and stuff, and then, you know, I'm just going to supersede the democracy.
All right. So, Sunday, you know, we'll, or no, Friday. What am I talking about? Friday, right? We'll see you all, right?
With the inauguration of the new Discord.
Right.
And maybe watching a video documentary on Guyana.
Who knows who may pop in.
That's what I was going to say. Like, we might just get railroaded from the very beginning with, like, invaders, with infiltrators, and that might not happen. But if everything stays relatively calm, I think we're going to watch a cool documentary about Guyana.
Right. And don't forget, in the new Discord, right, that you should all be joining by the 13th, because you can find copies of this book. Right, so that you can read along with us. All right. I'll definitely have Pat a walkie-talkie for 3 minutes.
Yeah, I deserve it. I deserve it.
Thank you, everybody, for being here with us. Happy birthday, Pat.
Oh, I'll definitely hand Pat a walkie-talkie. Very good. Thank you.
Have a good night, everybody. Law Salam. Stay strong out there, all right?
Yeah, everybody, be safe. Give our love to Sebs.
And boom goes dynamite.